Good afternoon to all dignitaries and participants. Welcome back to the second session today. I'm Dr. Vinita Dutta from Department of Chemistry, Banwarilal Bhalotia College, and the Secretary of E-Concerts 2020. I welcome you all to our final session of this international conference. It is a matter of great pride for us that we have Dr. Monotosh Dashgupta as the keynote speaker of this session. He is currently the visiting professor of Golpark Ramkrishna Mission Institute of Culture, Kolkata, India. He has done his PhD from Calcutta University before joining as professor in Krishnanagar Government College and Presidency College. He has been the principal of Kochbihar College. After retirement, he has been actively involved in teaching as visiting professors in many institutions like Calcutta University, Bidhan Chandra Krishi Vishwavidyalaya, Indian Institute of Social Welfare and Business Management, Jadavpur University, Presidency University, Badhavan University, Vidyasagar University. He has also been actively involved as the Dean and Controller of Examination in Netaji Subhash Open University. He has published nearly 32 books, and BB College family is proud to convey that he is also the alumni of this college. He is from the batch 1957 to 1959. Now, I would like to welcome Dr. Monotosh Dashgupta to enlighten us about the sustainable effect of philosophy and relevance of Vedanta on modern society. So, we are requesting to unmute yourself, sir. We cannot hear you.
Yes. Can you?
Yes, sir. No? Yes, sir. Oh. You are audible now, sir.
Thank you.
You want to share some slides, sir? Or some PowerPoint presentations you have, sir?
No.
Okay, sir. No. Please proceed. Please.
Good afternoon to everybody. Respected chairperson of this session, respected co-speakers, participants, organizers, the topic, exact topic of my today's deliberation is Be Well, Keep Well, a psycho-philosophical study with reference to Vedanta. Iqbal, the poet, has said, Sitaro se aage jahan aur bhi hai, abhi ishq ke inteha aur bhi hai, agar kho gaya ek nashman to kya gam, moka mat e aao funga aur bhi hai. Meaning, there is many more worlds beyond the world of the stars. More nests of love are awaiting you ahead. A nest of love has burnt out and you are lamenting over it. There are many spots for you to suffer and sigh. Quite evident that sorrow, tests, and death are dire realities in human life. Men of letters of the present only, more than 400 years ago, Shakespeare had written, "Oh, Gertrude, Gertrude, when sorrows come, they come not single spies, but in battalions." In Hamlet, Prince of Denmark, Act 4, Scene 5, Claudius the King said this to Gertrude, like many here, this also has turned proverbial. Although T.S. Eliot, in his lecture, Shakespeare and the Stoicism of Seneca, 1927, said that Shakespeare is not a philosopher. Here we are going to have a psychological and philosophical, that is psycho-philosophical observation on a practical direction or part of human life. Science can involve physiology also and include other groups of animals and even plants. Sir J.C. Bose, Indian physicist turned botanist, explained some physiological expressions in plants in terms of psychophysiological processes called cybernetics. Let us come to the point. To have peace, there should be a peaceful environment. It is also true that peace and tranquility are not synonymous. So also, absence of peace and absence of tranquility. But it is not so easy to draw a difference between them. A creative man becomes restless when he fails to create. Vincent van Gogh would often be landed in such situation. He would pain himself, strike his head against a wall. And when at last a piece of art would come from him, he would feel relieved. In this context, we can cite a letter written by Rabindranath to Mrs. Nirmal Kumari Mohalanobis. In this letter, Tagore, referring to his cultivation of the world beyond death, conveyed that the spirit of Jyotirindranath has said, quotation, "When I was on the earth, I longed again and again for peace. But coming over here, I find that happiness is also not a bad thing." Rabindranath had an explanation of this, quotation, "I have realized it as happiness is a thing that originates from will. It is associated with the object, with the feeling. Some real objects are necessary to grasp it." Quotation ends. And peace. Rabindranath wrote in Gitali, "Not sorrow is this, not even happiness. Deep peace it is, surpassing all in me, rang up where I don't know, crossing the house, living comfort, surpassing the self, took me along to a land beyond the life and death in the guise of wayfarer." Those who understand Bengali might recall it is dukkho e noy sukh nahe go gobhir shanti e je. This very song Sukumar Rai, the father of Satyajit Ray, wanted to hear from Rabindranath at his deathbed, from deathbed of Sukumar Rai. So, happiness is a limited feeling. It depends on environment, no doubt, but fully not so. Peace is a greater realization that is solely dependent on environment, but independent of the nature of the environment. Again, happiness wants to be spread. Yearning for happiness is a common phrase. Antonym of happiness is sorrow. That of peace is lack of peace. Lack of tranquility is quite different. Lord Buddha took a vow to remove sorrow, but he did not like to bring happiness. It may be said he searched a path leading to peace. He suffered from the lack of tranquility to find out the path. Be in peace is alternatively phrased as be well. Here comes a newer word, swasti, meaning good well-being. Rigveda 2:32:8. In Srimad Bhagavad Gita, there is indication for doing good to all. Even God is engaged in doing so. Anunash chintayanto mang ye jana tadupashate teshang nitta bhi yuktanang yogakshemang vaham moham. Meaning, who only worship me, to those thus associated with me, I do carry welfare. Rabindranath has used the word, used the word muhakshema, and Dhammapada also has used the word yogakshema. This means God also wishes that men will be well, but there is a precondition, and that is man will have to be good. How? Keeping all his attention and devotion directed to God. Vedanta has pointed out another significance of this. According to Swami Vivekananda, this is the central idea of Vedanta. Love for God is factually love for humanity. By the touch of love, inanimate objects turn conscious. The same ever-existing object would appear to be inanimate to the unwise and to be God to the wise. If that is so, why man who stands at the intermediate stage would not be raised to the status of God? Vedanta hits here. Vedanta says that love is truth and hatred is false. Love for God may be extended to love for humanity. If this becomes possible, heaven will come down on earth. This is the desire for God. He likes to see the creation beautiful. The Bible says that God created man in his own image. So the responsibility to keep the creation beautiful becomes vested on man. The beauty of Vedanta lies in the fact its teaching are not only rational, but at the same time, very general. Kant's first categorical imperative states, quotation, act, and so act that the principle of your action may at the same time be willed to be a universal law, quotation ends. This universality is expressed through Vedanta in a different way. The basic teaching of Vedanta is summed up by Shankaracharya in this way. The world and the ego were appearances, their reality being Brahman. Now, in Mandukya Upanishad, Brahman and his isomorph Om is limitless in the fourth quadrant, thus nullifying any demarcation between the whole and the part, small or big. Unknowingly also, one may think in the line of Vedanta. When Vivekananda urges not to search for God elsewhere without caring for looking just in front where he is moving in so many forms, Samuel Taylor Coleridge writes, "He prayeth best who loveth best all things both great and small, for the dear God who made us, he made and loveth all." And Thomas Gisborne writes, turn thy hasty foot aside, and not crush that helpless worm. The little creature, your wayward looks derived, required a God to form." This means that while aiming at the same thing, they like to preach the idea that in order to be well, one must keep well. In other words, peace can be achieved when the environment is peaceful. From these phrases like being well, keeping well, and seeming well, a term comes out that is beautiful. If others are kept well, then one will be well, and then the world will stem well. Individual welfare begets collective welfare. This is a scientific phenomenon. In thermodynamics, an ideal system is more possible if one goes to a macroscopic macro state through infinite microstates. If a component microsystem deviates from ideality, the whole system will deviate from the ideal state. But if a microsystem deviates, thus it is easier to get it back into the ideal state. Swami Vivekananda put forth this form, and here is how he differed from Karl Marx. While Karl Marx said that collective welfare would bring individual welfare, Vivekananda's assertion was reverse. Welfare of the aggregate, of the society, of the country, of the world come from individual welfare. So said Confucius. He said that all should try to be good. If anything big cannot be achieved, something small but good attempt is to be taken. If big endeavor be not possible, there should be attempt to make the surroundings beautiful. If forgetting oneself, one grasps something greater than the self, the life and the world would surely be more beautiful. Rabindranath called Brahman beautiful. Satyam, Shivam, Advaitam, the truth, the God, the non-dual, to him became Satyam, Shivam, Sundaram, the truth, the good, the beautiful. The ascetic practice for this beautiful makes a man altruistic. Herein comes the teaching of Vedanta, the special contribution of Vedanta to the philosophical world is this. If this teaching is incorporated into life of an individual, no matter what religious tradition he or she belongs to, the ideals of humanism, universalism, and harmony would infuse in him. Thus, even an atheist finds out a religion of his taste in Vedanta. If one believes in an omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient Brahman or absolute self, to him, the sentient soul becomes a minute but important, in the language of mathematics, plus zero, and demands proper respect. The same idea has been expressed by Voltaire in different language. He said, if God did not exist, it would be necessary to invent him. If there be an idea of common fatherhood or motherhood, the idea of a common brotherhood becomes rather spontaneous. What Rabindranath commented, beg your pardon, what Radhakrishnan commented for Mandukya Upanishad may also be attributed to Vedanta. Vedanta teaches super theism, which is far above theism, atheism, and antitheism. In Hindu scriptures, prayer takes the form Sarve Sukhina Bhavantu, Sarve Santu Niramaya, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kashit Dukkha Bhag Bhavet. Let all be happy, let all be healthy, let all see what are auspicious, let not anyone be stricken with sorrow. This happiness refers to all sorts of happiness, right from the mundane to much higher and greater, nay, the noblest one, emerging from the loftiest attainment through the deep realization. On the noblest side lies the happiness due to realization of the Supreme Being or Bhuma, because Bhumaiva Sukham nalpi sukhamasti. True happiness lies in the Supreme Being only. No happiness is in baser source. And Rabindranath here brought the term ananda. This ananda in Vedantic term is also bliss. Rabindranath in Gitimallo said that there is no end to it. With the minute particles with which our body is made, there is no end to it. Who understand Bengali? Tar onto nai gonai je anonde gora amar ongo tar onuporo manu pelo koto alor songo tar onto nai gonai. It has also been said that mutual welfare is to be sought by all. What is good is to be shared by all. Nobody can live all by himself. It is not realized unless one falls in the condition of Robinson Crusoe in Daniel Defoe's novel. Omar Khayyam writes, "A book of verses underneath the bough, a jug of wine, a leaf of bread and thou, beside me singing in wilderness, oh wilderness, where paradise and now." This happiness is transient. Such courage causes the pair to go to a distance quite apart from the locality, no doubt. But the words, loaf, bread, book, wine, begin with capital letters. For these human localities required. So one can be well through keeping others well. Al-Quran says, since the human world has come from a man, so there is a common kinship among all. So everybody should do good for others. From this belief, the Muslims in their daily prayer recite, Rabbana atana fid dunya hasanawat wa fil akhirati hasanatao. O our protector, give us the good and beautiful in this life and also in the life beyond. Surah Baqarah, Ayat 201. Vivekananda pointed that spiritual liberty and liberality of Vedanta had influenced Islam. He also said Vedanta is the basis of Buddhism and all other religions of India. The main point of this influence is man held at the center of importance. This has been very nicely depicted in Rabindranath's poem, who is merged in self and averse from bigger world, has never learned how to live. One is to run fearlessly, dancing with the waves of the great worldly life, keeping eyes fixed towards truth and being undaunted of death. Sarthamagna je jan bimukh brihat jagat hote se kakhono shekheni bachite. Jesus also said in the Bible, love thy neighbors. In Buddhism, the ascetics who after seeing the light of truth comes to give the test of that bodhi or knowledge to the common people are called Samyak Buddha. Those who are interested with the nirvana of themselves only are called Pratyeka Buddha. Undoubtedly, the former arhats or the ascetics are superior. Buddha still distributes yogakshema among the suffering humanity through these Samyak Buddhas. Psychologists attribute a greater importance on mind in respect of this feeling of happiness. To them, this phenomenon of be well, keep well originates from the feeling feel well, which is solely a mental affair. To some extent, it is also an instinct or drive. Of course, mind of the psychologists quite differ from that of the Upanishads. In Upanishad, mind is a sense organ, and according to Srimad Bhagavad Gita, the greatest one, scientists have not been able to define mind clearly. There is no mind in the embryo formed by the union of a sperm and an ovum. Even in the following stages of evolution, mind remains absent. In the discipline, philosophy of mind, the nature and mutual relations of different activities of mind have been discussed. How they are classified and how they are related with different objects, energy, and human body, especially the nervous system, are also experimented upon and analyzed. In course of working with mind, philosophers, nay, the scientists, have paid attention to two things. These are moral and intentionality. Purposeful activity is the specialty of moral, while intentionality is active in material system. When emotion got added, naturally, the insensate system was left out. But what about plants? We have referred to Sir Jesse Bose's cybernetics earlier. In 1900 came out Sigmund Freud's The Interpretation of Dreams. He showed that mind has three strata or regions: preconscious, subconscious, and conscious. Their differences are determined by their relation with consciousness. Another term comes here, that is unconscious. We would not go into details of them. We can only try to come to a generalization after him. But since it is a subject of psychology, everyone has the right to differ. A part of the ideas accumulated in the subconscious layer of mind floats up in the conscious layer of a man. A portion of it is rejected outright by his critical faculty. He calms the second portion by rapid resistance. Otherwise, it would occupy him in such a manner that is not intended by him. There are some more thoughts that do not get any chance to float in the conscious layer. In spite of all concerted efforts, a large number of thoughts float up in conscious layer. Had not this happened, this would remain beyond his reach. According to Freud, a self-observer earns the ability for pathological explanation with these elements. He also gets an ability also for construction of dreams. If we give up the case of construction of dreams, we see that the conscious mind can and does behave in the reverse way also. That is, he likes to send the consciousness back to the subconscious or preconscious layers. From here, without any resistance or repression, he can bring the thoughts in the conscious layer. We can relate with this, the theory presented by Freud in the 23rd lecture of the book Psychoanalytic Criticism, 1920, to see that the sensor perceptions present in the subconscious layer of mind serve as internalized representatives of an individual. Conflict begins between these and the prohibited, especially erotogenic or sexual thoughts, and the real thoughts comes out in a changed form. The cheap methods of putting disguise on these unconscious thoughts of mind are condensation, displacement, and symbolization. Freud has told of sexual subjects, but we, by generalization, can take any subject whatsoever. we can associate with this the extension and modification provided by Freud's disciple Carl Gustav Jung, namely the theory of collective unconscious. Jung asserted that the modifications proposed by Freud gets accumulated in the society. Those collect in myth, religion, and popular practice, customs, and usage. As they rest in the aggregate, it is also the dream of an individual and rests in the imagination. It is also the dream of an individual and rests in the imagination of an individual. So these enter into literature and stay there. So past sorrows become present experience. Miseries of certain time become thoughts for well-being of the society. Darkness that prevailed once turns into a thirst for light at present. Racial repository of Jung creates a vow of the present generation. Let others not suffer as our predecessors did. Let the tomorrow be beautiful for all, illuminated for everybody. But the present situation, due to novel corona or COVID-19, all over the world is so dark, dull, dismal, disappointing, and depressing that the slogan, "Be well, keep well, feel well," has turned just into a mockery. Here, Vedanta will give us hope and courage. Vedanta's God is not a theory, not a man. You, I, he, all are God in individuality. We are all immensely powerful. Vedanta lays stress on love for others, intention, nay, aspiration to work. Vedanta also believes on self-confidence and self-assertion. So, confiding on Vedanta, let us jump for concerted effort. Let us hope and believe we will win over the situation. To be well and to keep well is our right. Vedanta is our might. Schopenhauer has said, from every sentence of the Upanishads of Vedanta, deep, original, and sublime thoughts arise, and the whole is pervaded by a high and holy and earnest spirit. Who knows not, might is right. Let me conclude here, thanking all concerned, including organizers, for giving me this scope, and Mr. Soumya Ghosh for electronic assistance. I take this as a gift on the occasion of my continuous Diamond Jubilee year of teaching career. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir, for your beautiful deliverance. We are
Hello, Zarqua. Can you just place your mouthpiece near? Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir, for your beautiful deliverance. We are highly honored to have you in our colloquium today, and your talk has really soothed our soul in this hour of crisis. So. We came to learn about the love for God and love for humanity, which is the basic teachings from the Vedanta as well as the other religion. So we would like to have you from you some lines regarding how this love for God, love for humanity, happiness, peace are interlinked with sustainability, and what are the current paradoxes which we face in this context.
Beg your pardon, it was not clear actually.
Yes, sir. Sir, we would like to have from you some lines regarding how happiness, peace, and the spirituality and sustainability are interlinked, and what are the current paradoxes we are facing currently in this context.
Sir, can you unmute yourself, sir? We can't hear you, sir. Sir, can you hear us, sir?
Video test.
Sir, please unmute
yourself. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, you are audible now.
Then again, repeat the question.
So our question was, how sustainability is interlinked with love for God, love for humanity, happiness, and peace? And what are the current paradoxes we are facing in this context? We would be highly obliged.
Yes, in this context, yes. Spirituality and love for God. Love for God, I have said, love for God is love for man.
Yes.
Because God is in every individuality. And as Vivekananda said, I have also quoted his remark. Now this, if we take man as individuality and try to serve man, it will be serving humanity. For example, say at the very present situation, when the world is very much facing very much distress and difficulty with this COVID-19. We are trying our best to give a relief. I myself is connected with a group of research. We are researching on firstly a drug and then a vaccine. I know not when it will come, but as I have quoted this Vedanta said that man has infinite potentiality in him, and it is man who can turn and unturn everything. Therefore, I am sure that man will win over this situation, and one group of persons will serve a bigger portion of the humanity, so that we can see a better tomorrow. But again, the chairman of the session, I think, he's a man of chemistry, and in 1864 and 1865, there was a principle laid down by La Chatelier and von Braun. That is, when an equilibrium, one factor changes, other factors change in such a fashion so as to nullify the change that has occurred. We actually disturb the nature. Therefore, nature took revenge, and we will win over the nature. Nobody knows that a serious or more serious disease will come to baffle us. This will go on, and thus it is our duty, or it is our responsibility to keep the creation beautiful, because God has vested, if we believe in God. Our Vedanta, I have said, it is above theism, atheism, and antitheism. It is super theism. If an atheist also finds a religion of himself in Vedanta. Therefore, we try for humanity, and that is religion of this day. Is it clear?
Thank you, sir, for your satisfying answer. The next question which we have is, what are your recommendations for achievement of sustainable development regarding peace, religion, philosophy, and modern society?
May I request, Tarka, to please refer to the name of the name who has asked this question. Okay. Please refer to that name who has asked this question.
Yes, sir. We have this question from Mr. Joshua. And the question is, what are your recommendations for achievement of sustainable development regarding peace, religion, philosophy, and modern society?
Love, love, love. In all Indian languages, it is called prem. That is infinite love. Love originated from the very be extended to the wider and widest portion of humanity. love for all. There was no there will be no concealment if we happen to discover the drug or happen to discover this vaccine. There will be no concealment. We will not share it with others. This will not do. Shokoler tore shokole amra. Protteke amra porer tore.
Thank you so much,
sir. Thank you very much, sir. Over to the anchor, please.
Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful talk.
Thank you so much. Welcome.
Yeah. We have to now move to the next invited talk of this session, sir. Thank you so much once again.
I think I am the oldest among this multitude, isn't it?
Yes, sir. And I am happy that you are from chemistry also.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Now we are moving to the next speaker. Our next invited speaker of this session is Dr. Biswajit Roos. And we are very happy to have you, sir, with us. Sir, you can unmute yourself. Dr. Biswajit Roos is currently the head and senior principal scientist of the Environmental Engineering Group in CSIR CMERI Institute in CMERI Institute in Durgapur, India. He has done his MTech from NIT Durgapur and research in Jadavpur University, India, and McMaster University, Canada. Dr. Roos has 27 years of research experience and significantly contributed in the field of environmental sciences. He has developed processes for removal of excess iron and arsenic from groundwater, plastic waste disposal, and energy recovery through pyrolysis and plasma pyrolysis route. Dr. Roos received many prestigious awards. To cite a few, Raman Research Fellowship Award, CSIR Technology Award 2017, received from Honorable President of India, Sri Ramnath Kovind, Scientist of the Year 2015, and Environment Excellence Award 2017. He has published more than 100 research papers and filed 13 patents. Besides being an editor of reputed journals, he is also involved in Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, Government of India, in biofuel sector. He has handled 15 research projects, 2 international projects, and delivered lectures in many places in abroad like Poland, Czech Republic, Canada, Italy, and US. Now, let us have the pleasure of listening to Dr. Biswajit Roos. He will deliver lecture on an interesting topic, plastic waste, and what should be our sustainable approach towards their safe disposal and energy recovery. So,
good afternoon to all. First of all, thank you for nice introduction. Thanks to the organizing committee for giving me an opportunity to deliver a talk in this e-Conscious 2020 program. So I'm going to the, I'll share some screenshots. So screen is visible. Hello.
Hello, sir. You are audible. Your screen is also visible. Sir, proceed with the lecture, sir.
Okay.
Yep.
So you know that the topic that is plastic waste, sustainable approach towards safe disposal and fuel recovery. I am from CSIR family. So next slide, I will show you that. Overview that that is students should know that about CSIR. Those who are doing research in science or in arts or in engineering, they might be knowing that CSIR. They are getting fellowships, maybe UC fellowship or CSIR fellowships. So in addition to that, what is the role of CSIR in India, particularly in the country, that you know that research and development for benefit to the industry and society, the basic objective. There are 38 national research laboratories all over India. In West Bengal, there are three, in Calcutta two, and one in Durgapur, that is Central Mechanical Engineering Research Institute. And you know that award, that Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, that is also offered by CSIR, the highest award in science and engineering in India. So in addition to that, CSIR fellowships, this is the basic objective of CSIR. This is the R&D focus of our research, of CMER, engineering design, manufacturing, mechatronics, engineering, energy and environment, agricultural machinery, industrial and technology, technical consultancy. We have right now around 130 scientists in our institute. Okay. Now, you see, I'm coming to the topic, overview of the presentation. It includes that introduction on plastic and plastic waste, problems in marine environment, that is, it is recently observed that marine environment, how will that impact on that due to that plastic waste. And solution through, I will discuss two methods, particularly that pyrolysis and plasma pyrolysis process. And I will try to compare with both the process. And at the last, I will try to show you, that if time permits, then one video on plasma arc processes. Okay. So on an introduction part, I can say that plastics, everybody you know that uniqueness, plastics. Why day by day it is getting popular? Because you know that physical and chemical properties is so excellent with respect to transparency, permeability, flexibility, solubility, chemical resistance, so on. Relatively low cost, easy to manufacture. Okay? So that's why it displaced many traditional materials such as wood, stone, bone, leather, paper, metals, glass, ceramics. That's why it is getting popular. And the main problem is that it is not biodegradable. That's the main problem after use. Okay. So in the left hand side of that slide, you might have seen that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, that's number is there. When we procure some materials, plastic material, you might have seen this number. So if you see the number 2, then it may be that material, it is HDP, high density polyethylene. So there are 7 categories of plastics: 8, LDPE, PVC, LDPE, PP, polystyrene, like that only. And you see the demand of plastics in India in case of 2013, that is mostly that is PP, LDP, HDP, and PVC. Okay, so.
Sir, we are sorry to interrupt you, sir. Can you hold your mouthpiece a little nearer to your mouth?
Okay. Sorry.
Thank you so much.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much.
You just see the slide, the right hand side of that bar, that is packaging industry. It uses around 40% of plastics, packaging industry. So there are the industries like agriculture, electronics, automatic, building, and so on. So on the packaging industry, they are utilizing around 40% of plastics in our world. And you know that MSW, that is municipal plastic and municipal solid waste, it also contains that plastics. It is around 10 to 11% of plastics. It is a mixture of different plastics, PP, LDP, HDP, include all. Now, the problems comes at the after use. Most of the cases, we use as a single use plastic, that is disposable in nature. After use, you see that in every minute, we are dumping one full garbage truck of plastic waste to the ocean, right? We just imagine in every minute we are dumping one full garbage truck of plastic to the oceans. In a real scenario, it is a very practical. You see that what is our solution of disposal of plastic waste? Okay. In reality, if you see that there are two processes. First process is simply we are burning it, right? If we burn it, then what is the problem? That we are generating greenhouse gases, carbon, a lot of carbon dioxide, etc., etc. And whatever the energy contained inside the plastics, that is also we are losing. Okay, so the first issue, that is we are try to dispose that plastic through burning. And other alternative way, that is simply we are throwing in an our nearby areas. So what will happen? What will happen? Ultimate destination of that plastic waste, what we are throwing to the nearby area, that is to the ocean. Okay, just simply you throw a plastic to the nearby area, ultimately due to rain or due to wind, it will go to the drain to canal, canal to river, river to ultimately ocean. So now it is observed currently that there are actually 46,000 pieces of plastics litter floating in every square miles of ocean. This is the research data supplied by UNEP. If the things are going such a way, then you just imagine by 2050, there will be more plastic than fish. You see the fate of that marine biome. The nylon ropes, the recent incident, that is shocking deep discovery of plastic whale by scientists in Norway. They observed that dead whale in the coastal of the Norway sea beach. After postmortem, it is observed that its stomach was filled of plastic trash. Okay, so including 30 intact large plastic whales. It is not the one case. You see that in Thailand in 2018, that a case study where recent death of a whale from eating more than 80 plastic bags. It is also a recent incident, that is in Spanish beach, one whale that is dead due to consumption of that plastic. They don't know whether it is eatable or not, but as it is not biodegradable, not eatable, not digestible, that's why the ultimate fate of that whale you see. So marine environment is drastically getting affected due to plastics. So what are the solutions? If you go back to the chemistry of that plastics, you see that carbon hydrogen, the basic element is carbon hydrogen. In addition to that carbon hydrogen, there are other elements also, that is nitrogen, chlorine and oxygen also. It depends on the application of that plastics, where we are going to use that plastics, then only we are putting that other elements like nitrogen and chlorine. In case of PVC, you see that chlorine is there. You know that PET bottle, that is which we, that is PET bottle that is we keep with the drinking water, that is polyethylene tetraphthalate, that is oxygen is there. In case of nylon, it is also a polymer. Nitrogen is there, that is polyamide. So basic element is carbon hydrogen, right? So you know that is the basic chemistry of that polyethylene, polymerization of ethylene, it's called polyethylene. This is a very interesting table. You just see the colorful value. First 1, 2, 3, that is polyethylene, polypropylene and polystyrene, all are plastics. Okay, you see the calorific value of plastics, that is around, if you on average, that is maybe 43 megajoule per kg. Whereas coal and wood, you see the calorific value. For coal, it is 32. It is a very good quality of coal, then only. Otherwise, if it is a northeast part of coal, then it may be 20 or 22 megajoule per kg. In case of wood, it is 18. So if you compare with the coal and wood, that calorific value is much, much higher than that of this coal. So if you, when we are burning it, that plastics, what will happen? We are losing this huge quantity of energy, that is 42 megajoule per kg, that amount of energy we are losing. At the same time, we are deteriorating our environment by polluting, by generating carbon dioxide gases. So this is the challenge of the our scientific community, engineering community, how to extract, how to recover that energy that is particularly, that is the real challenge. Then at the same time, you may get the safe disposal at the same, another way, you may get the energy that is recovered from the plastic waste. So that is a challenge, how to recover that energy, huge quantity of energy. This is the motivations, why? Because you know, the plastic is non-biodegradable in nature. It can sustain the soil or water in everywhere, that is more than 100, maybe 200, 300 years. Improper disposal techniques, right, and carbon hydrogen enriched waste, and minimize energy crisis. Okay, so these are the motivation to proceed for this pyrolysis and plant pyrolysis. Objective is very simple, that is plastic waste disposal and energy recovery. So in here, in case that we try to cover, that is thermal process. There are so many processes, biological process, mechanical process. We'll try to hear that is thermal process. In thermal process, there are also different process. So in here, pyrolysis and plasma pyrolysis, I'll try to explain it. Pyrolysis, basically, it is a thermal decomposition of any carbonaceous material. Carbonaceous material means carbon and hydrogen must be there. Okay, at elevated temperature, not normal temperatures like 100 or 200, in absence of oxygen. So what is happening? That is, that is a thermal degradation of carbonaceous material in at elevated temperature in absence of oxygen. This is called pyrolysis. This is a high temperature phenomenon. This is basically, pyro means high temperature phenomenon. So if you go for a pyrolysis of plastics, we will get three products, that is solid, liquid, and gas. Okay, solid may be char, black residue. I'll come to the picture next slide. Liquid, it may be in the form of pyrolytic oil. It is a crude oil. And gas may be hydrogen, methane, copper, like that one. So three products we'll get through pyrolysis. Now the question is, at what temperatures we'll go for pyrolysis? So for that, thermogravimetric analysis is there. That is called TGA analysis. From TGA analysis, we need to know that what is the temperature to degrade that plastic material. So that's why TGA is very much essential for going for the pyrolysis process. So you see the from the TGA analysis, that is it plastic waste is a, it degrades from 350 to around an ANC to 550. So this is the degradation temperature. It depends. Three products I have told you. That it is a basically thermal dependent. Okay, if you increase the temperature, then product yield will be different. So this is the basically basic block diagram. You see that reactor inside is there. This is a closed system. We are purging nitrogen from outside to make it oxygen free, to make it inert. Then we are heating. Okay, the plastics. What will happen as on when go for heating at temperature of 400, 500 or 600, it will degrade. After condensation, you will get some oil that is liquid in nature, that is called pyrolytic oil. It is a crude oil. After fractional distillation, that can be converted to the, other products like petrol, diesel, kerosene, that only. And char will be remain after the experiment at the bottom of the reactor, and gas will be also emitting at the end of the reactions. So this is the actual laboratory setup. It is basically for R&D purposes we have developed here. And this is the result of the pyrolysis. You see the bar, that is the blue color, it is oil. It is around, see the 450, 500, 550, 600 temperature. If you go on increased temperature, that product yield is varying. That is in, on an average, you can say that is 80% oil, 10 to 12% is gas, and rest is char. So this is the quality of pyrolytic oil. It is a fractional distillation unit. You may get that petrol, diesel, and kerosene also. The fractional distillation oil product, or pyrolysis product. This is the setup of 15 kg per batch. It's a batch process. Okay. So there are different processes. I will try to explain you. That is a batch process, semi-batch process, and other process is continuous process. Okay, first it is a batch process. What is the uniqueness of this batch? You will see the and the red, right hand side, there is this collection, gas collection system is here. That is combustible in nature because hydrogen, methane, ethane is here. So we are trying to utilize this gas for heating of the pyrolyzer, right? That is the uniqueness of the system. Most of the cases, if you see that gas is flare-upping that gas. But here we are trying to gas to utilize to heat the gas. So it is regenerating all the systems. Okay. The TCD, the thermal conductivity chromatogram, we have very good facilities. So the infrastructure is gas chromatogram. We are detecting, quantifying the gas. What is the gas and what is the amount of gas through the TCD and FID? FID detects only the hydrocarbons only. So if you see the general average composition of pyrolytic gases, that is hydrogen, CO, CO2, methane, ethane, like that. Why CO and CO2 is there? If PET is, if we use the PET, that is oxygen is there, that's why maybe the gaseous composition you may get CO and CO2 also. So we also done the while analysis, but not all the parameters, but few parameters important. Parameters we have done, that is density, thrust point, calorific value. You see the calorific value is around nearer to the diesel and petrol, and density is also nearer to petrol diesel, and thrust point also in between petrol and diesel. So this pyrolytic oil can be directly used to the for combustion for heating purpose in the industry. Or that can be fractional distillation. So if you see the chart is also very important because if you activate that chart, then chart can be utilized for activated carbon. Okay, this is a, I'm not going in details to this. There's a chart also on the combustion analysis. Techno-economic analysis and patent. I am not going in details to techno-economics, but for students, those who are doing research, for them, I am trying to impose that some of the things, words, that is techno-economic analysis. Why techno-economic analysis is required? Because if you see that our research findings are very encouraging, leading to develop a product or process, then techno-economics analysis is very much essential. Otherwise, that what for we are doing research, for the society or for the industry. The industry will be attracted, will attract if the this process is cost effective, then only that will come to you to take the technology for commercialization of this product or process. So my dear students, so this is important things that techno-economics analysis. One more important word, that is patent. You know that in India, we are very much far away from the other countries like China and Japan. We are least bothered about patent filing. We are only publication, right? But if you see, particularly for the research students, my suggestion, if you see that your results are, very encouraging, leading to the process or product, first you will go for a patent filing. Otherwise, you may lose that IP, that is intellectual property, right? So that is an important issue, that is patent. We are very far away from the Japan, China, and other countries also. So research students, please do that. We have also demonstrated this setup to when Dr. Harshavardhan, Science and Technology Minister, visited in our institute. I'm now coming to the plasma arc pyrolysis. Basically, this is high temperature, very high temperature. You see the middle of that diagram, it is plasma pyrol gasifier. It runs through electricity, right? So basically, it is a closed chamber plasma arc. We are generating plasma arc through carbon and graphite electrode. So when electrical power is passing to the carbon electrodes, at the tip of the electrode, arc will be generated. We are putting here three electrodes in our system. So with these systems, we are generating plasma arc zone. It is a temperature of more than 3000 degrees centigrade temperature. When we put that plastic into the 3000 degrees centigrade temperature in the closed systems, immediately it will disintegrate to the syngas. Here we are getting only one product, that is synthetic natural gas. It is a basically combination of CO and hydrogen, maybe other hydrocarbons, lower hydrocarbons, because it, the basic advantage of these things is because of high temperature, it's produce only syngas, because highly, heavy hydrocarbons, it cracks that because of temperature, the lower hydrocarbons. So we are getting only gaseous product we are getting from here. So after gaseous product, we are cooling and cleaning it, and then we are sending to the energy recovery systems of that syngas, and we are getting electricity. So plastic waste too, we are getting electrical power. This is our 20 kg per hour capacity continuous process plasma arc disposal systems. Okay, this is a plasma arc, and this sorts of plastics we are using here in our cases. This is the TCT gas, we are analyzing it. This is also techno-economic analysis, I'm not going into details. If you compare with the plastic plasma to conventional pyrolysis, you see the initial investment for plasma pyrolysis is high, but for conventional pyrolysis is a less initial investment. For plasma pyrolysis, huge quantity of plastic waste that can be treated at a time. For batch process of pyrolysis, conventional, less quantity of plastic waste is effective. Plasma pyrolysis cases, only one product, that is fuel gas we are getting, which is clean gas. And conventional pyrolysis, so we are getting three products, gas, pyrolytic oil, and char. So in plasma pyrolysis, almost all sorts of plastic waste can be disposed of. But there is some restriction for conventional pyrolysis. Biomass, paper, wood, that can be avoided. Otherwise, you see in case of biomass or paper, that is hemocellulose is the nature of the biomass. Due to that, quality of the pyrolytic oil, it may be acidic in nature, it is very difficult to utilize for further cases. So this is the comparison of between two processes. This is the link. I'll try to show you that one video of that plasma arc pyrolysis lead time permits. Just wait for just. I'm trying to connect on that video.
Okay. Great.
Video.
Thank you so much, sir, for your informative lecture.
Just a video.
Thank you, sir, for your informative lecture. Now, energy recovery is the most resource efficient solution available when compared to landfilling or even post recycling. Your talk was really informative, but the question which we have from our end is, which type of pyrolysis would be more feasible for our economy and would be more sustainable from the point of ecology?
I have compared that pyrolysis conventional and plasma pyrolysis. Plasma pyrolysis, it is already available in the developed countries like in Japan, in USA also, in Germany also. But here in case pyrolysis, it will be cost effective unless it is a continuous process, right? So it is a batch process, may not be interest for the industry. If it is at least semi-continuous process, then also be possible. But right now, there is no continuous process of plastic disposal process. So we are trying to here, that is to make a continuous process plastic waste disposal system. That will be more effective for disposal of plastics. So can you share that video? Just wait for a minute. Sound Video is visible?
Yes, sir. Nicely visible.
Okay. This is a gas engine. It is converting syngas to electrical power.
Okay.
This is the three electrodes. You just see, just like a wicket. It is a feeding system, this two-stage hopper. Mm-hmm. Left side, you just see the illumination of bulb. That is electrical power through plastic waste. Plastic waste to electrical power. We don't have any capacity to convert whole gas to the syngas. That's why most of the gases we are trying to flaring off. And few, maybe 10%, we are trying to utilize to power generation. This is a control panel. I forgot to tell you that 1 kg of plastic generates 3 kW of electrical power. So 1 kilowatt is to run the systems, and around 2 kW it is excess. So in that way, that can be cost effective. If it is scale up, then it will be more effective. But initial investment is a little bit high with compared to conventional pyrolysis systems. Sir. Thank you.
Thank you for the detailed illustration, sir. Just one short question.
Yes.
Whether or what are the chances of establishing this technique in India? Are there any chances?
Yes, of course. Right now, you know that we are a R&D developer. We do research and development. We are not implementing our commercialization. So thing is that we are transferring that know-how or technology. We have transferred this technology to the number of companies. They are now trying to implement commercial agents. Ministry of Railways and other ministries, they have shown interest to implement such kind of plasma pyrolysis, basically. So these are the things.
Thank you very much, sir. Over to Dr. Benita.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your valuable knowledge with us. And now we proceed to the next invited speaker. It is our great pleasure to announce that for the next invited lecture, we have Dr. Nilanjana Deb with us. She is an associate professor at the Department of English at Jadavpur University, Kolkata, India. Dr. Deb has valuable research and contribution on the topic 19th century migrant laborers going from Kolkata to plantations across the empire. She is also actively involved in digitizing the collections of British India Association from 1847 onwards in collaboration with the British Library. Dr. Deb is presently the co-investigator of the Rucha 2.0 project on bodies of difference. Today, Dr. Nilanjana Deb is going to share us her valuable insights on Kolkata's alternative futures, a vision statement in difficult times. We are eager to hear from you, madam.
Right. Can you all hear me? This is the first time I'm actually trying this webinar format.
Yes, yes, Nilanjana Deb, we all can hear you. This is Ajay. Please go ahead.
So it's a pleasure to meet all of you online in these difficult times. We can't meet in person, unfortunately. But I think that the earlier talk by Professor Rouge is something that resonates a lot with what I have been thinking about in recent weeks. You know that in Bengal, we've been hit by this double, shall we say, triple crisis now of the coronavirus pandemic, which is leading to an economic recession, the plight of the migrant workers who have been hit in many ways, not being able to get home. Even if they get home, where are the jobs? Where's the income? And of course, the super cyclone Amphan. Now, in the process of doing relief work for both the families of migrant workers as well as for the super cyclone hit areas, in fact, one of the things that has really been bothering me and other people from different NGOs, student organizations who are doing relief, is the question of plastic waste. Is that all the relief that we are sending out from the city and the suburbs of the city is wrapped in tons of plastic. Not only that, and this is one of those sort of, you know, moral conundrums. A lot of us are sending out, for example, packets of sanitary napkins for women in the affected areas, but these are non-biodegradable. Where is all of this, you know, huge amount of waste going to go? So on one hand, you have, feminism requiring that, you know, hygiene products be distributed amongst women. But at the same time, we haven't yet moved to a point, I think, in our ecological consciousness to have enough of, you know, biodegradable products for women's hygiene. So, you know, we are stuck in this situation where we are literally and willfully cluttering more and more pristine areas of the Sundarbans, rural areas of Midnapur, with a lot of plastic. Necessary, but again, something that perhaps with more foresight in future disasters, we will be able to anticipate and avoid. So the city is something that easily resorts to the use of plastic. I mean, in this case, it's a humanitarian need, but if you go to shopping malls, if you go to your local departmental stores in the city, everything is wrapped in plastic. There are only a few places which will offer you the option of taking away things wrapped in maybe brown paper or newspaper. A few small networks of farmers who are trying to distribute things wrapped in cloth bags, but that's not enough. I mean, look at the population of Kolkata. We are essentially lakhs and lakhs of people who are now convenience junkies. It is the convenience of plastic that has turned our cities into really unsustainable spaces. So thank you, Professor Rooj, for thinking so deeply about this problem and trying to develop practical solutions as to how to dispose of or perhaps reuse the plastic waste that we are producing. The arrogance of cities around us. Kolkata is perhaps a few years behind Bangalore, Delhi, and Mumbai. Delhi has killed the Yamuna. Bangalore, you know that there are water bodies. There's a lake that is actually always on fire because of the chemicals that have been spewed into it. Bombay killed the small rivers that surrounded it a long time ago. And which is why you will see that Delhi is soon going to be facing, it's already facing a severe water crisis. Bangalore will be facing a severe water crisis by 2025. Mumbai has other problems on its hands. The regular flooding, for example, of the city every time the monsoon hits. And at the same time, these are cities that are becoming, even as you know, they are growing, they are becoming, in that sense, more developed cities than Kolkata. There are also cities that are decidedly unfriendly to the poor. The cost of living is extremely high. And I would argue that that has a lot to do with the way in which the city, by its sheer lack of understanding of urban ecology, of the need to see the city and its inhabitants as part of an ecology, is something that is at least in the way in which we're going right now, not going to be sustainable in the future. But I'm not concerned about Bangalore or Mumbai or Delhi today. I'm concerned about Kolkata, because we, in a sense, much like Bombay on the Bay of, on the Arabian seaside, we, with our very precarious position at the edge of the Bay of Bengal, are going to be the city that will receive, in the event of sea level rise due to global warming, the largest influx of environmental refugees. Those of you who've heard from your parents, grandparents, the stories of, you know, the lakhs of refugees who came in after partition, or even after the Mukti Juddha of 1971, you know the enormous amount of pressure it put on the infrastructure of the city, the competition for jobs, the sheer desperation and poverty that, you know, engulfed the city. Is Kolkata equipped to deal with this kind of influx, inevitable influx in the future? I think that if we are going to even consider Kolkata as capable of absorbing gracefully that kind of influx, we have to ask some serious questions about what are the possible futures of the city. Because there can be a dystopian future, certainly. But there can also be other futures, which we could term them urban socialist utopias. We could term them simply, I don't know, speculative fiction at the moment. But there are futures that we have to consider. I think that... since, I mean, this is the centenary celebration of the college, it might also be important to consider that this is also the 150th year celebration of Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi's birth. And what he had said about the sustainability of cities, he had called cities Bishfora, you know, the point, like large boils on the body of the nation. Because that is where you have this concentration of, you know, several things. One is surveillance, because governments in post-independence India have moved towards more and more and more urbanization. And that urbanization has several ends. One is apparently convenience, that the more people you have concentrated in one area, such as the city or mega city, you can efficiently deliver goods and services to those people. But on the other hand, if you think about it, this is also then ideal, an ideal situation for surveillance and control, right? That is exactly the kind of dystopia that, you know, we apprehend in you know, in India, which is moving increasingly towards a kind of totalitarian state. Now, remember that Gandhi, in his writing, frequently cited this verse from the Isha Upanishad: "Isha Vasya Midam Sarvam Yat Kinchan Jagat Tyang Jagat Tena Tyaktena Bhunjata Magrida Kasya Svidhanam." And his interpretation of that was that nobody is entitled to consume or waste more than they have rightfully earned by the labor of their body or the labor of their intellect. Anybody who consumes more than that is effectively stealing. To use the Bengali term, chorjobritti, churir mulobod. And unfortunately, the city in contemporary India, which has in a sense subscribed to a capitalist mode of production, with just a sort of passing nod to its history of socialist planned economies, the city is a space of conspicuous consumption. A space, even Kolkata, perhaps not as much as Mumbai or Delhi, is a space where you have a culture of consumption and waste. You have a tendency to think of resources in terms of use and depletion, and never in terms of how to replenish, to replace that which we are using. That is never part, as it were, of our model of development in modern capitalist India, which is that beyond the model of resource extraction, extract whatever you can, you know, the crops from the soil without repairing or healing the soil, extract minerals at the cost of, you know, the destroying the land cover, forest cover, and the lives of tribals. There is this resource extraction mentality, which is never counterbalanced by a mentality of replenishing, of repairing, of healing. Certainly not in the city. In the city, most people do not even contemplate, for example, the notion of, you know, them as citizens being capable of replenishing or repairing the soil. They say, where's the soil anyway? You know, we're surrounded by concrete. Where will I repair the soil? Right? But there is soil all around us in the city, which is why I keep sort of coming back to this point about, you know, understanding that the city is an ecology. It is an ecological system, a complex urban ecology. And unless we understand that, we cannot really think of the city as a sustainable space in the future years. There are all these sort of grand visions of, you know, the smart city that many of you will have heard about. Jakarta in Indonesia wants to be a smart city. There are cities in India that are bidding to be smart cities. And apparently, you know, everything being digitally wired, all citizens' data being connected, will allow goods and services to be delivered efficiently. Even, you know, the water sprinklers that sort of water city plants in public spaces like parks can be controlled by digital means. But you see, the smart city, exactly the point that I'd made earlier, is also something that is framed by corporate capitalism. It is IBM, for example, which is fueling this sort of, you know, race or this demand for the smart city. Do smart cities ever exist? Can they even actually exist in a country like India, right? I mean, what would be the point of Kolkata, for example, you know, becoming a smart city when it's possible that only, you know, the sector 5 and the sort of new tech hub area would be the smart city, and Khidirpur, Behala, you know, these areas would never really be part of the smart city. Their fate would remain, as it were, hanging in balance. So this idea that somehow cities will become more sustainable, more efficient, cleaner and safer, simply because IBM is wiring everything from the street lamps to, you know, water sprinklers, etc., is really something of a capitalist dream, a capitalist fantasy, really. Because you must realize that if everything is wired, everything is being watched, everything can be measured, you know, you have this sort of swiping biometrics everywhere, then there is a human rights impact. There is an impact on the rights of minorities. There is an impact on the rights of women. There is an impact on the rights of various, sort of disempowered communities as well. They either get left out or they are monitored and controlled. The kagaz nahi dikhayenge no longer remains an option, because everything that, you know, you are is digitized, mapped, and, you know, measured by digital systems. So, you know, and we really don't know the long-term cost benefit of these smart cities. What is really the environmental impact of these systems? No one really knows, any more than we know about, you know, what will happen when we shift from 4G towers to 5G towers. There are countries, there are cities in Europe, for example, who have voluntarily, as a city, said that they will not move to 5G towers. They choose to remain with 4G. They will not progress further. Why? Because there are apprehensions that it will affect, you know, pollinating insects like bees. It can kill bees. It can kill birds. And do we really want that in the future? Because, you know, in the city, it's not just us human beings. There are plants, there are insects, there are animals who also share the urban ecology. And if those are affected, I do not think that, you know, we can imagine somehow that we will live with our little world of conveniences without getting hit as well. So what is the second alternative? The smart city is obviously not a viable alternative for Kolkata. And certainly, I mean, if you just think of the practical aspect of it, one super cyclone wiped out the city's electricity in, you know, Kolkata's neighborhoods for days on end. There were almost riots in neighborhoods demanding electricity be restored, right? And imagine if, you know, some similar natural disaster happens and all of these fine digital systems just go haywire. So the entire smart city becomes extremely unsmart, all right? That there is in fact so much dependence on these digital systems that if those somehow get affected, then the whole smart city and all its inhabitants just reach a state of chaos. So what is the option with the rising influx of migrant workers, refugees, a huge tidal wave of joblessness and unemployment that seems to be engulfing our immediate future? Do we see then an alternative to what Kolkata was in the 70s, where you had student uprisings, where you had, leftist radicals demanding through, a range of methods, a more equitable, set of living conditions, working conditions in the city? Do we see a return to the Kolkata of the 1970s? I'm not sure that is something that Kolkata's urban middle class, again, with its complacency, would want to see. So do we see a kind of descent into a kind of police state versus radical groups kind of, street warfare scenario again, with the middle class alternating between, smugness living in gated colonies and a sense of helplessness at what is happening around them? And what are they eating in this kind of dystopian future? Middle class and elite people, if they can afford it, will be buying chemical-free food at extremely expensive prices. And you have those who are not able to afford chemical-free food buying carcinogenic-laced food, cheap vegetables, mercury-laced fish, from the local markets. Because most of the local markets from Kolkata, as you well know, especially the farmers selling vegetables from the South 24 Parganas, grow food like tomatoes separately for their own family. For the market, what they are sending is often laced with, very dangerous chemicals that ripen the vegetables faster or make them look fresher longer, right? So recipes for cancer, certainly, right? So you see a future where the rich can afford, if they can afford it, buying more bottled water, spending more and more on RO water filters, which themselves deplete groundwater from the city. And those who cannot afford it, as the groundwater depletes, having to drink water that is laced with arsenic, more and more iron content, leading to greater health problems. All right, so we are seeing not just in terms of incomes, but in terms of lifestyle choices, or rather the lack of lifestyle choices, a huge gap in the city between the rich and the poor in the coming years. And that is something that we have to then think about. So the second alternative of as I said, this dystopia of a state, where you have radical groups, attempting revolution, and you have police, and you have this huge gap between the rich and the poor. That second alternative is obviously not something that most of the, people in Kolkata would want, as it were. What then is the third alternative? To speak about the third alternative, I would want to refer you to a wonderful short story written by Donna Haraway called Camille, the Children of Compost, in which he speaks about a world of the future where the soil has been completely damaged, biodiversity has been completely damaged. It's a world of the kind that, the second alternative is headed towards. But there is hope, because in the Camille story, human populations try to repair the earth. It's called the Children of Compost because these communities of humans, by their own choice, limit their population, develop symbiotic relationships with various endangered species. So they are committed, as it were, to each protect one species, and also constantly composting. In other words, whatever food you cook, or before you cook, the peels, fruits, vegetables, etc., leftovers, composting it, creating soil. Right now, many of you don't know, we just have about 6% of the earth's soil left suitable for cultivation. 6%, all right? 94% of our food production worthy soil is gone, topsoil is gone, right? So we have to make soil composting. And even if in cities we can't do agriculture in the way that, in rural areas people can, we can make soil, right? We can replenish the soil. We can do micro level food production if possible, to reduce the dependence, the parasitical dependence that Kolkata and other cities have on the hinterlands around them. It's ironical because, unlike many other cities around the world, Kolkata is actually a city that fits in with Donna Haraway's vision of, the Children of Compost. Because the East Kolkata wetlands are a space where our urban farmers developed a way of recycling the wastewater, the sewage of the city, all right, figuring out how, to a certain depth of the pond, a certain time to leave the sewage in the, in these ponds or bheris, so that you have most of the coliform bacteria dying out, the organic pollutants in the water also settling down, being neutralized by the sunlight, right? Actually creating out of sewage water, water that is suitable for fish culture, pisciculture, and also vegetable food production. That is the reason that this, use of sewage for food production by the simple intelligence of our farmers, right? That has led to Kolkata still having cost of living much lower than cities like Bombay and Kolkata, all right? And yet, in that alternative future, the more dystopian future that Kolkata is staring at, we actually have now a scenario where huge portions of the East Kolkata wetlands are being first deliberately killed. And I use the word killed because I have been there and I have spoken with Juba Ghosh, who's carrying on the work that Dr. Jubajyoti Ghosh, the literally called the father of the East Kolkata wetlands. What they told me was that the minimum amount of sewage water that needs to come into the wetlands to keep them alive, the government is deliberately not allowing that quantum of water into the wetlands. So the wetlands are literally dying. They're being killed The next step is they're turned into agricultural land or marshy land. The next step is you have these huge multi-story complexes and corporate buildings coming up all across the what we call the Bheri side of the bypass. All right, so we are literally from having a good start, being the only city that is actually thriving because it has grown on the edge of a wetland. We are actually like the proverbial Kalidas who cut off the branch on which he sat. We are killing the very wetlands which could have ensured that our future is not as dystopian as the futures that stare Mumbai or Bangalore in the face, or Delhi, most of all. So, you know, it's something to think about, which is that what prevents the people of Kolkata from making these small changes in their lifestyles that would allow for a more sustainable future. Like I said, composting, it's very simple. You know, all the waste in your home, simply, you know, through either aerobic or anaerobic decomposting processes, you know, to turn that into compost and to use that in every available space in the city. Cities abroad are already doing this. Wherever there is any available free space, people are growing food, all right? Havana in Cuba, my teachers in natural farming, Aparajita Sengupta and Debol Mojumdar, taught me how Havana grows nearly 80% of its own food within the city, all right? What prevents Kolkatans from doing that? And this is where I, as a humanities person, would like to intervene, that it's not just about scientists developing, you know, new ways of recycling plastic or new ways of disposing waste. It's also about something that, you know, Gandhi talked about, that Ambedkar talked about, which is human attitudes towards waste. Something as fundamental as, you know, the fact that most people in Kolkata don't even clean their own toilets. They always assume that there'll be somebody else to clean it after them. Right? Perhaps the lockdown is a good thing, that people are learning to do these things that they imagined that, you know, people from, poorer homes or the lower castes would do for them. Right? So the whole idea of composting and accepting it as a part of your life is linked fundamentally with class issues. It is fundamentally linked with caste issues. And which is why I think that, you know, if we are going to make Kolkata a sustainable city, we have to work on attitudes. And those attitudes are not going to be coming in, you know, from the blue, like a bolt from the sky. It has to do with the education system. It has to do with how we are teaching the next generation of young people right from the primary school level. You know, teaching them to, you know, work with the soil. You know, the reason why I brought in Gandhi was that, you know, his idea of Nai Talim, that you don't teach physics and geography and all of these subjects through textbooks. You teach children these through doing things with their hands, you know, through handicraft, through working with, you know, gardening tools, gardening, farming. And through that, you teach them, you know, the fundamental concepts of science, geography, ecology, etc. So, you know, that kind of notion that Gandhi had of using physical labor, all right, and creating a generation comfortable with physical labor, all right, and also incorporating that ethics that no work is dirty, no work is lowly, is so important, I think, for us. We need to create alternative education systems, you know. Tagore had that idea, but that went awry after Tagore passed away. I mean, today Shantiniketan is not doing the kind of radical, rural reconstruction work that it could have done after Tagore. All right, that is a fact. But that doesn't mean that we can't have alternative education systems coming up across Kolkata, across Bengal, where these attitudes, eradicating, you know, the caste mentality, the mentality of you know, elitism from children's minds from a very early age. All right. So remember then that perhaps what we are dealing with here is really a battle for young minds. All right. It's about ethics, inculcating a certain ethics that allows people to think about the planet first, the sustainability of the city first, and their own convenience second, right? Remember what I said right at the beginning, the city, if there is something that defines the city in our everyday lives, it is this easy reaching out for convenient things, the plastic wrapped, foil wrapped things that we use from morning till night, all right? To shift from that to an attitude which is, let me put my planet first, all right? Should I buy this because it's wrapped in plastic, or should I buy that, perhaps not so fancy looking, perhaps not so posh looking, but because it is available wrapped in paper or a banana leaf, etc., right? So it's really, the battle is not going to be on the streets, you know, in that dystopia that I was talking about. The great battle for Kolkata's sustainable future will be in the education system, in creating a generation that after us, all right, I mean, we will be doing what we can, trying our very best, but who will create a city that has a much more resilient infrastructure in terms of food production, in terms of also, you know, children who are taught from a young age to deal creatively with conflict resolution at the cultural level, and because in the future, when Kolkata is flooded with more and more refugees coming in from the Sundarbans, coming in perhaps also from the Bangladesh side as the sea levels rise, will we have a generation, a future generation equipped, as it were, to deal with these without the city descending into a dystopia, a horror story? So, you know, at the root of everything then is this need to get rid of the babu mentality that people in Bengal have. You know, go for desk jobs, IT sector jobs, children being brought up to see education as, you know, means to getting a multinational job somehow. Not teaching children to interrogate their own privilege. All right.
Ma'am, so sorry to interrupt you, ma'am. Can you just brief in the next 5 minutes?
Yes, of course. A
little bit out of time.
Yeah, of course. Just a couple of minutes more.
Yeah, ma'am.
All right. So the children learning that, you know, what they enjoy in the city as children of middle class families is literally living off the blood of the working classes, right? I think the migrant labor crisis that has happened in our time after the coronavirus pandemic lockdown has to some extent woken people up to how dependent we are on our migrant workers. We are not seeing the consequences now, but many of the migrant workers will not want to go back to the cities that have betrayed them, right? And then where are we going to get all the labor, you know, to keep our convenient little worlds running, right? So, you know, it's important then that our education system, many of you who are attending this conference will go on to become teachers at the school or college or university level. And I ask you to be more interventionist in that approach, because, you know, it is possible, very easy to descend into a dystopia, but it is much more challenging to creatively and courageously teach young minds, to open up young minds to a better future for our city and for our planet, right? So I conclude here with just a couple of lines that I had penned in my response to this triple disaster that has hit Bengal right now, and its link with a sustainable future. And I just want to share that with you, because really what we are discussing now is not just some high-flown academic jargon. This is about your survival and my survival now, all right? So this is my conclusion, and I read it out, just a couple of lines. Nothing is impossible. as the coastal areas start flooding seasonally because of global warming, how will the people who call these lands home live and eat? How will Kolkata accommodate them? Kolkata and other large towns of Bengal. Nothing is impossible. Humans can innovate if we start planning and work now. Task one is to replant millions of mangroves so that the damage to the coast is reduced. Kolkata will be safer the more we save our mangrove forests in the Sundarbans. At the same time, we need to plant deep-rooted food-bearing trees, nitrogen-fixing plants everywhere possible, everywhere, and I mean every part of Bengal. The second task is that the urban, non-coastal areas of Bengal need to save their wetlands, harvest water, repair the soil, and increase their localized food production. Drier districts like Purulia, etc., which are not big food producers so far, need to learn fast from countries that have done arid farming and grow crops like millets that need less water. The third task is that which I have been talking about, which is developing resilient, intelligent infrastructure in Kolkata and other large towns and cities of Bengal, further inland from the coast, to absorb the influx of environmental refugees from Bangladesh and India in the future. And when I say intelligent infrastructure, I don't mean the smart city. I mean people-centric, people-friendly cities. Thank you.
Thank you so much. This is Rajushree here. Hi, Niranjanandi. We have a very interesting questions coming from various participants. But before we move on to that, I was just reminded from your talk, I was listening to Chandan Sen, Chandan the theatrician, while you are going to going through the Basanti Highway, a village in South Chobish Parguna. He pointed me out towards the wastewater that is coming out from the Bantal tanneries, and actually the producers in the Thapar Mart that goes out to the vegetable markets in and around Kolkata is actually fed from those water, the carcinogenic water, wastewater actually. Yeah. It was not recycled, not anything done to it. So therefore, the design, the arrogant design of the city you talked about is palpable everywhere actually. In the eviction activities of a corporate mafia nexus, etc. And when recently we are organizing aid works from a JUX group of ours for Sundarbun, generally, this is also a point to be noted that we couldn't find any biodegradable sanitary pads for the women there. That means, could we infer from this that even this corporate mode of capital, capital mode of production in the cities we look around, not supporting the cause of the environmentalism?
Absolutely.
Because we couldn't find any biodegradable sanitary pad. We have to buy those non-biodegradable things for the aid works of ours even. We couldn't, this is the case. So just go into the questions that we are having. This is one. What can be a viable way out for this migration to Kolkata from lesser developed areas when there is already such a saturation point we see and reach in Kolkata? What can be the viable way out of this migration?
I think the viable way out is, as I said, the fact that villages are seen increasingly by farmers, by villagers, as economically not attractive places, right? So yeah. If you want to live a good life, you must come to the city, right? That effectively is the attitude that needs to be countered. And many of my friends, particularly farmers who have literally moved from the city. You've heard Aparajita's talk on the first day. She moved from being an urban person, somebody who lived in Kolkata, to being a full-time farmer. And she has been trying to, through her writing, her speaking, convincing people that you can actually have a very good life if you have intelligent design and planning in the village itself. It's just a question of, also selling the idea that the village is a better place to live. Right, that can, in the present scenario where literally the cities are spaces which are poisonous in every sense of the term. You know, the village is a much better place, a much healthier place to live.
Yeah.
And also in terms of resistance, you know, I mean, villages being seen simply as spaces that supply food to the city.
Passive recipient of everything city produces, right?
Exactly. Yeah. So, you know, the city is the market. If we can break that so that you have villages and districts trading with each other rather than, you know, constantly looking towards the city for a market. That over dominance of the city needs to be broken, as it were.
And this structure of mind which talks about we go ahead to train the villagers, the agriculturist, rather than doing this, we should be a reverse recipient of the training and from their side actually to sustain the city.
Absolutely.
So I think we are quite a little out of time, Niranjali. Thank you so much for being with us. Even if it is in a digital platform, we would like to have you someday in our college premises in the future, perhaps, when we return to the normal, from this new normal. So when we meet and gather. So thank you so much.
If there are any questions, I'd be happy to, you know, if any, you can email the questions to me.
I'll email to you the list of the questions. And
thank you so much. And thank you again for having me over. Thank you.
Thank you so much. What do you mean?
Thank you so much for your wonderful talk. Thank you for being with us. Now it's time to listen from some of the emerging researchers and faculties from our participants. They'll be getting 5 to 6 minutes each to showcase their research and discoveries. And we'll start from one participant. We could not have him in the last session. Dr. R. Bindang Menzen. He is a faculty in Fuzzy Ali College, Nagaland. And they will deliver a talk about sustainable agriculture, invigorating the traditional method of cultivation in Nagaland. So we are transferring the focus to our participant. Are you here? Are you here, sir?
You need to unmute yourself, Mr. Bindang Menzen.
Yes, sir. I have unmuted.
Yes.
If you want to share any PowerPoint presentation, you just share screen with us.
Sure. Finally, I hope I can do my presentation now.
So, we can't see your screen.
My screen is not visible?
No, sir. Are you seeing a small green button saying share screen?
I'll check out once.
Yeah, please.
Please bear with me.
Yeah.
Can I continue without you, or?
Are you seeing the button, share screen button, in your laptop?
I'm using my phone. I could not use my laptop.
Okay, there will also be some share screen option.
Okay, madam, I'll check out one.
Just see for a few seconds that you get it or not.
Okay, yes. Share documents. Is it possible to do with Microsoft OneDrive? Share screen. Okay, fine.
Okay.
Is it visible, madam?
Let us wait for five seconds. Maybe the condition will be clear. Can I just continue? Yeah. We can see you. You are visible now. Yeah.
Can you see the slide?
Still not. It's a no.
Okay. Is it visible?
No, not visible yet.
No, still not visible.
Madam, can I do without you?
Yeah, no, you just continue without it. I think one of our technical leader, he is trying to accommodate the slides, if it is possible. Okay. Okay. Oh, we can see. We can see.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, just select your PowerPoint, please. Yeah, beautiful. No, just go on. You have a limited time, actually. We're already running out of little schedule, so we request you to finish within 5 to 6 minutes, please.
Okay,
please,
madam. Please. Thank you so much for considering my request, and I would like to present this presentation hurriedly. The topic is on sustainable development and curating the traditional method of cultivation in Nagaland. Looking at the present population, we have a total of 7.8 billion. And according to the World Food Program 2020, lives and livelihood of 265 million people in low and middle income countries will be under severe threat due to the present pandemic. So moving ahead with this situation, we have a solution, which I call it sustainable development. And from yesterday, we have been discussing about this sustainable development. And I would like to discuss about this definition of sustainable agriculture. The Wikipedia defines sustainable development as farming in sustainable ways, which means meeting society's present food and textile needs without compromising the ability for current or future generation to meet their needs. The farmers in the state still practice the traditional method of cultivation. And there is a need to reinforce this traditional method with modern technology for sustainability. Quickly, I would like to give a brief introduction about the study area. Nagaland is located on the northeastern region of India. It has a total geographical area of 16,579 square kilometer. My study material includes food primary and secondary sources of information, and it is basically descriptive and observation in nature. Quickly do the findings. Looking at the population, there are 71% of population of Nagaland dependent on agriculture, and the traditional method of cultivation, which I've mentioned, is jhum cultivation. This jhum cultivation is a practice on a cyclic process. The fields are rotated after cultivating for 1 or 2 years. And this cyclic process depends upon on village to village, where some villages, if they have few very small land, they will have 7 to 9 years. And those big villages have a cycle of 10 to 15 years. It is a time-tested system of cultivation, and it is subsistent in nature. A recent study conducted by the Nagaland Environmental Protection and Economic Development, NIPID, and the International Institute of Rural Reconstruction have concluded in their study that jhum cultivation is deeply rooted in the Naga psyche, having evolved through the years and being rooted in custom, beliefs, and folklore. So moving ahead with this, since it is not possible for the farmers to do away with this traditional method of cultivation, I would like to suggest some measures where the method of cultivation can be improved upon. So here, we can see in the picture a bioethanol, which can be used as a good method to convert kitchen waste into useful nutrient-rich manure. Here in the picture, we can also see some segregation method which can be done in the household and that can segregate biodegradable and non-biodegradable waste. This type of practice will help in waste management as well as generating organic manures. In the farms, organic composting units or bits can be constructed. With this system, we can encourage the local youths to take up entrepreneurship on waste management. This will ultimately lessen the burden of waste disposal for the municipal and village panchayat. Along with that, the farmers can be encouraged to construct compost pit in the field, and they can practice this system, a method where compost heaps can also be used in the field, which can be decomposed and used as manure in their field, so that it will help in higher production and sustainability. There's another method, the traditional method of condor bonding along the hill slope can be reinforced to protect the top soil and the organic manure. This condor bonding is a traditional practice where they lay the logs along the condors and that will protect the soil erosion. In conclusion, I'd like to state that the present pandemic has brought the world into a standstill, which we are all facing today. And large-scale exodus of migrant labor have destabilized the economy. Along with that, the climate change has also adversely affected the agriculture sector. And there is threat on food security the world over, which we are all worried about. So every possible measures need to be taken up from the local level to prevent this crisis. These are some reference which I have taken for my study. And thank you for your listening patiently.
Thank you, sir, for your talk. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, madam.
So, sir, the question which we have is, we have heard earlier that zoom cultivation is such that a part of land is burnt and then the it is then again reused later for reculture or agriculture.
Recultivation. Yes.
So is that method sustainable?
It is like this.
Or does it harm the ecosystem?
Actually, this is a system which many scientists have objected to this type of farming. But looking at the way the traditional practice is done, we have found that this cultivation is sustainable. Why? Because this system of cultivation is done in such a way that the farmers, they will cultivate that area for 1 or 2 years, and after that, they will go to the next field, and it is a cyclic process where they cultivate one after the other. And as I mentioned, like in some villages where they have small plot of land, then they will have around 7 to 8 years of cycle. And those villages having larger area will have 10 to 15 years of cycle. So it is saying that the longer the zoom cycle, the more fertile the soil becomes. And because of this, I feel that the traditional practice cannot be done away with. And since sustainability is very important, I am suggesting this technique where they can use this organic manure which are generated from the household or from the field itself.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. Now we'll go to our next
thank you,
speaker. Now we'll go to our next speaker, Dr. Amitabh Naik. He's a faculty from Tribeni Devi Banwarilal, Tribeni Devi Balotia College, Raniganj, West Bengal. He will tell us about the allopathy science and natural phytochemicals, the future of sustainable agricultural development. Sir, please, we are focusing it. I think you are already co-host now. Dr. Dr. Binzam Timan, you please stop sharing your screen. We request our technical team to shift the focus to the next speaker, Dr. Amitabhu Nayak from PDB College. Sir, are you with us? We request you to unmute yourself. Dr. Nayak?
Yeah, I am.
Thank you so much, sir, for being with us. Sir, will you want to share your screen? There is a green button there. You have to click it. And
it is now visible?
Yeah. It's clearly visible. You can go to the presentation mode also.
Okay.
And sir, you have 5 to 6 minutes. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Sir. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, everybody. Myself, Dr. Amitabh Nayak from Department of Botany, PDB College, Raniganj. Express my sincere organizer of BB College. And special thanks to the principal, Dr. Amitabh Bosu, for informing me regarding this seminar. Today, I will present my research work entitled as Allelopathy Science and Natural Phytochemicals, the Future of Sustainable Agriculture Development. So, first of all, we have to know about what is sustainable development. Madam, is it visible?
No, it is not visible, sir. You need to share your screen.
Okay, I think so. Is it now visible?
No, sir. Down below, see, there's a green button. You just click on that and select from the options.
It's visible, sir. You can go with this mode of presentation also. It's clearly visible
okay.
right now.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So first of all, we have to know about what is sustainable agriculture or sustainable development. Sustainable agriculture actually aims the reducing to the incidence of pest and disease in such a way or such a degree that they do not seriously damage the crops. It will cause or hampering the natural ecological balance of ecosystems. At the same time, it will kill the pests or weeds. One of the main aims of this sustainable agriculture is to rediscover and develop strategies whose cost and ecological effects are minimal. That is why it will affect negatively to the and will give the benefit more than its negative effect. So, the use of synthetic pesticides has undoubtedly resulted in achievement of green revolution in different countries through this crop production. However, in recent years, there has been considerable pressure on consumers and to the farmers to reduce or eliminate synthetic pesticides in agriculture, which is causing a dangerous or negative effect on the environment as well as the ecosystem. And this concern has been encouraged researchers to look after for better alternatives in near future. Synthetic pesticides have played a major role in crop production, as we all know, related to the intensification of agricultural system. In recent years, environmental side effects and health concerns raised by an indiscriminate use have led to EU to the ban of many synthetic pesticides. As a result of this drastic revision or drastic change in the drastic decision, currently there is a strong need for a new and alternative pest control methods. An interesting source of biorational pesticides may be represented by the biocidal compounds naturally occurring in plants as the products of secondary metabolites or secondary metabolism. Phytochemicals are mainly the secondary metabolites produced in plants by various metabolic pathways after the production of glucose or end product of photosynthesis. Terpenoids, alkaloids, flavonoids, flavonoid derivatives, and glucosinolates, and saccharins are some common natural phytochemicals present in plants, as you know. Groups of secondary metabolites most promising for the development of pesticide formulation are the glucosinolates, and more generally, terpenoid phyto constituents such as the essential oils or other constituents are suitable for the production of bio pesticides or bio herbicides like that. So due to time constraint, I will not go in detail of this. So phytochemicals have are the chemicals as I already told that the secondary metabolites and have the adaptability or capacity to produce or to defend the plant or itself from various insects and pests or like that. And we are trying to use these features of the phytochemicals or trying to exploit this nature of phytochemicals to formulate a biopesticides. And now, what are biopesticides? Biopesticides is basically a formulation which contains active substances, and at a very low, small doses, it can repel or can control or can destroy the harmful organisms like pests, weeds, etc. And there are these biopesticides are basically two types in nature. Two major categories are there. One is chemical herbicides, and next one is natural herbicides. And the natural herbicides are maybe of fungicides, herbicides, insecticides, algicides, molluscicides, etc. And chemical herbicides are basically the hypochlorates, hydrogen peroxides, and chlorine bleach. Within hypochlorate, there are they may be of sodium or calcium hypochlorate. So the biosynthesis of the secondary metabolites is usually restricted to specific stages of plant development. That is, the after photosynthesis, it produces a secondary metabolite, or it turns to different metabolic pathways and produces some essential oils or like that. These are mainly the secondary metabolites, and these secondary metabolites produce the interact with plants in our environment to protect the plant against predators or pathogens or invasive species. And some related to the productive mechanism of the plant, say for example, for attract the insects for pollination, etc. So the interspecific interaction in which one species inhibited while the other species neither benefit or harm is called anomalization, as we know, or antibiosis. The process of inhibition basically is achieved by the secretion of certain chemicals, and these chemicals are called actually the allelopathy. And now, what is allelopathy science? Allelopathy is a natural process where one plant interacts with other species by chemical means of the chemical working, and so it is also considered as complex chemical work. Here, the plant produces a number of water-soluble organic compounds which have the ability or which have the capability to suppress the growth of and development of other plants or other plants. The plant and the chemicals are actually called the phytochemicals. To concern alternative to synthetic pesticides to reduce pest population, discuss with growth or experiment to critically analyze the allelopathic property of Parthenium histoplus by using these diagrams or that is the Wigner data as a biochem material. And my experiment showed that the leaves, that is the leaves means the leaf extract and leachates of leaves of Parthenium histoplus have a strong allelopathic property. And I have done the multidisciplinary experiment where physiological, biochemical, and as well as genetical experiments are also being done to confirm the allelopathic property. And this indication of inhibition growth of black gum seedlings by Parthenium may be exploited to formulate the natural herbicides, and which required further investigations in future to produce the biocide. This is just the preliminary concept, and thank you for patient sharing. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Do you have any one question can be allowed? Zarqua, will you proceed for only one question? We have a little bit time crunch. Thank you so much, sir. It was a very nice presentation.
Yes. Yes, I have just one question.
Yeah.
The question is, sir, whether the insecticides which you have isolated from the among the phytochemicals have any harmful effects on the pollinators, because they are also insects. Have you tested for this?
No. It is yet to be done. The phytochemicals, the effect of the phytochemicals on the plant itself, as well as the beneficial insects or the good insects, what we actually called, yet to be screened out. And this is a very nice question, and it should be keep in my mind for further research. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. Over to Dr. Vinita.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Dr. Nayak. We are proceeding to the next lecture. Pragya Porimita Nayak. He's a researcher from North Odisha University, Baripada, Odisha. Are you with us? Pragya yes. Porimita Nayak, are you with us?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Do you have any presentation with you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so please quickly just press the green button. See, share screen button and share your screen with us.
Okay.
You have 5 to 6 minutes max. Okay. Just quickly say what you have done. Okay. Yeah, proceed, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Respected sirs, ma'am, and sir. I am Pragya Porimita Nayak, research scholar from North Odisha University. I am going to present the topic entitled as Sustainable Development of Agriculture and Need for India. This is a joint paper, and my co-authors are Lipuna Khatei and Kiran Bala Swami from North Odisha University, Manindar Hanaga from Central University of Odisha, and Rajat Kumar Malik from Kalinga College of Bhubaneswar. These are my scheme of presentation. What is sustainable agriculture? It means production of food, fiber, or other plant or animal product using farming technique that secure environment, public health, human communities, and animal welfare. It is required to protect the natural resource base to prevent the degradation of soil and water, to conserve biodiversity, and it contributes to economic and social welfare of the community. It integrates three main dimensions, such as economy, ecology, and the social dimension. It also plays an important role in sustainable economic development and in hunger and poverty eradication. Hence, it is a prime need for developing countries like India to sustain growth and development. In our study, we have taken two objectives. First one is to study the trends of food grain production in India, and second is to analyze the important factors influencing sustainable agriculture in India. This paper based on secondary data collected from various secondary sources, and simple statistical tools are used to analyze this data. Here, why India needs sustainable agriculture? Because of continuous fall in soil fertility is one of the biggest problem in many parts of India. And sustainable farming restores the soil and it improves fertility and soil structure. It also raises the organic matter content of the topsoil, thus raising its ability to maintain and restore water as well as fertility. And sustainable agriculture practice reduce energy and use at all levels and eliminates the needs for fossil fuels. And local sustainable farms puts emphasis on local food production. Therefore, it provides employment opportunity for local people. And also, it practices involve mixed cropping, which promote diversity of crop production. And food security is a pressing problem in India. the slow growth of agriculture production in India is due to lack of awareness about the treatment of crops, limited access to modern farming technology, and shrinking of agriculture land and irregular monsoon. In terms of human health, crop production. In terms of human health, crop growth. Hello? Am I audible, ma'am? Crop grown through sustainable agriculture are free from chemical and pesticide, which is better for people. This limit the risks of people becoming ill from exposure of these chemicals. Moreover, sustainable agriculture practices helps to reduce income inequality, thus facilitate poverty eradication. These figures shows the trends of food grain production in India. The trend of food grain production gradually increasing. Food grain production marginally declined of 2006. Although overall food grain production shows and rising trend, but is very falling. Thus food production in India then with small and marginal constitute 85% of the total lending by the Indian economy likes enhancing the viability of agriculture. The goal of long-term food security can be attained if agriculture is made sustainable through reform in agriculture policies and agronomic practices. Then, what are the factors affecting affecting sustainable agriculture? The modern technology in India is slow in the farming practice to happen and on-site. The net income from agriculture. More pressure on the education facilities in way agriculture depending. The farmers are less risk bearing and unskilled, which adversely impact on their income from agriculture. Natural calamities is a common phenomenon in India. On the other hand, most of the farmers do not have crop insurance scheme. The agricultural insurance scheme are inefficient to overcome various risks in agriculture sector. And then the conservation and enhancement of ecological is a major factor balance for sustainable agriculture. Then lack of awareness among the people about the methods of sustainable agriculture practices and its benefits. Many new technology fail to become applicable in agriculture sector due to lack of acceptability by the local society.
Kindly brief your rest of your lecture in next minute, please.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, we are already in conclusion. Then the important issues in agriculture development is the necessity to improve productivity, generate employment, and provide a source of income to the poor segment of population. The farming and climate change all adversely impact on agriculture productivity and production. Here. Include that the agri needs to achieve development resources and territory. Then attempt must be done to support farmers and electricity must be supply to them. They feel insecure and continue to die of drought, flood, and fire. Thank you.
Thank you, Pragya, for your talk. No questions from the audience. Over to Dr. Vinita. Dr. Vinita.
Thank you. Do you have any question, Zakwa?
No questions.
Okay. Thank you so much for your talk, Pragya Panita.
Just one question. How does the government ensure greater food for the growing population by sustainable agriculture?
Here, sustainable through sustainable agriculture, governments should aware the should aware some programs are
I think we are facing some technical issues. I'm sorry, we are not audible. Thank you so much, Pragya Porimita Naik. Maybe the participants can send her question through email if it is needed. Okay. So we are moving to the next speaker today. Mr. Shahabuddin Ahmed. He is a researcher from Guru Ghasidas University, Chhattisgarh. And he will deliver a lecture on Fiction for Ethical Justice and Sustainability, a Postcolonial Ecological Humanities in Amitabh Ghosh's The Hungry Tide. Are you with us?
Thank you, ma'am, for giving me an opportunity to share my...
Welcome. We are already a little bit
time, so I request
you to finish in 5 to 6 seconds.
Now, I'm going to share my PPT presentation on the screen.
Yeah. Just share screen button. You can just press.
Okay, ma'am.
Are you seeing it? Yeah, we can see.
Okay.
Yeah. Your presentation is visible. Yeah.
Hello everyone. Myself Shahabuddin Ahmed. Today I am going to discuss my topic, Fiction for Ethical Justice and Sustainability, a Postcolonial Ecological Humanities in Amitabh Ghosh, The Hungry Tide. Next, in my talk, I would like to discuss the major characteristic features of eco-critical reading of her text. First, I'd like to discuss the point eco-criticism, that is the study of the relationship between human and nature, and it is the application of ecology and ecological concepts to the study of literature. Now I would like to discuss the next point, sustainability and sustainable development, that is the study of preventing environmental damages that may have long impact on future generations, and promoting all kinds of development goals, gender equality, proper balance with environment and other disciplines, and moral and ethical considerations regarding environmental problems and the responsibilities of humans towards nature. Next, the major points are, it covers ecofictionality, anthropomorphism, shift from anthropocentrism to ecocentrism, ecojustice, eco-sustainability, ecological ethics, eco-emancipation, toxic elements, misunderstanding about natural world. Next, I'd like to discuss post-colonial ecological humanities from here I would like to discuss ecological humanities as a multidisciplinary areas of study that emerged in the 1980s in regarding to environmental degradation and the responsibilities of humans to it. It aims to bridge between the gap and to think about the values of the natural world and the place of humans within it, and the post-colonial condition, how the post-colonial, in the post-colonial state, how the colonial legacy and neo-colonialism and the exploitation of natural resources and the issues of modernity and the issues of the question and the questions of social, cultural, political space on rights of and ethics values of third world people and the natural world in equal situation and the sustainable development and that are concerned. And then the focal points how the impact of Western hegemony on the post-colonial nation states and its people and environment are concerned. Next, I would like to discuss the main topic, the Amitav Ghosh, The Hungry Tide. Amitav Ghosh is a post-colonial writer. In his novel, he brings about a lot of elements and events of the history of India, post-colonial space and location and creation of the East Bengal, impact of neo-colonialism and the Western hegemony, impact of Western hegemony upon the post-colonial nation states and the questions of rights and the space of cultural space of minority subalterns and native settlers within the post-colonial space and the question of nation and identity that are concerned. In the novel, Sundarbans is the setting, that is the tide country, where we find the major political cultural shift in terms of its socio-cultural and ecological balance that is concerned, and the inhabitants of the islands find no place within the post-colonial space, natural surrounding and settings, and the ongoing struggle of the native settlers to cope with the existence and both voiceless nature and the marginalized are equally exploited in the Sundarbans, and the displacement exile of the native settlers from its that is concerned, that is Morinchappi incident that is mentioned in the novel. People struggle in the natural world for settlement and survival, they struggle against nature, the tide, the storms and the tiger, snakes, crocodile are concerned. In this novel, we find out how nature as a living entity and the importance of nature in the lives of humans and the mercy of natural world. Next, I'd like to discuss how Ghosh brings all those things from ecological perspectives and post-colonial perspectives. The tide country is the only confluence of rivers and the sea, but the place of amazing meeting point of different cultural qualities, and it has the power of presence of energy creation and ecological balance in its own unique way. Now, in my concluding part, I would like to discuss how Amitav Ghosh blends imagination with history, facts with fantasy, with human insights, and he always stresses on the reader's awareness and minimization of the anthropocentric activity on nature, a peaceful coexistence between humans and nature, and achieving sustainable development goals, gender equality, rights, health, through the management of ecological humanities discipline. So here I am ending my discussion. Thank you so much for watching and listening.
Thank you so much, Shahabuddin. Little time actually for that. So I'm telling all the participants that if you have any question for Shahabuddin, he will be available through email. We'll send the email of the presenters. So are you okay with it? So we can just proceed with that. Thank you so much. So we are moving to the next speaker, Mr. Chayan Mukherjee. He's a researcher of Jadavpur University, West Bengal. Shayan, are you with us? Please unmute yourself.
Am I audible now?
You are clearly audible, and please share your screen. Please stop sharing your screen so that our next speaker can do it. Yeah, please share your screen. You can see the share
button. Just one moment.
That's okay.
Just one moment. Let me know if you can see the screen.
Let us wait for 1 or 2 seconds. Taking time. No. Till now we are not getting your screen.
Okay.
Can you try once again? We are not seeing your screen. Now it's visible.
Is it visible now?
Yeah. Go to your presentation. Yeah.
Okay.
You have 5 to 6 minutes. Yeah, please proceed.
Okay. So, hi everyone. I hope everyone is doing good amidst this COVID-19 crisis. Thanks to all the organizers for allowing me this opportunity to, you know, be part of such a great knowledge sharing discussion by eminent speakers, and also allow me this opportunity to present my thoughts on this subject today on sustainable health and happiness at eConcess 2020. To give you a quick background about myself, I'm an independent researcher and an ex-student of Jadavpur University, and I'm also currently a data science professional in Bangalore. So basically the way the world is moving towards sedentary lifestyles, so basically we, the human race, are accelerating towards a precarious future, right, where happiness is being closely linked with the power of our wallets and exhibition of our material possessions on the social platforms. So humans are basically nowadays moving, you know, and forming closer relationships with machines than humans, thanks to technology and how we are using it in our favor. Excuse the sarcasm. The main goal of this presentation is to discuss, you know, the potential impact of a world that is moving fast towards artificial intelligence on sustainability of health and happiness of fellow human beings. Now, we are mostly victims of illusions that are driving us towards suboptimal health and basically trapping us within false parameters of happiness. It is important that one should understand that these temporary flashes of happiness should not be mistaken for sustainable happiness, and how one should embrace technology in their favor to build a more sustainable human and machine ecosystem. A recent publication by the Harvard Medical School defines happiness in these three broad parameters. If you're feeling good, so basically if your pleasure is being maximized or your pain is being minimized, or if you're engaging fully into something, so it's like a state of intense absorption, which they have termed as flow, or if you're, according to Aristotle's notion of eudaimonia, if you're doing good, searching meaning outside yourself, in that case, these are the sources of happiness. However, apparently most of us suffer from what we are calling as false parameters of happiness, like having more money, you know, having a secure job, or going for movies, enjoying your youth, having, you know, the different kinds of food that you like always, or owning a luxurious collection of cars. This is one of the slogans, you know, it's very attractive, I found across the web, which shows that gross national happiness is more important than the gross national product. And this had been a slogan in the School of Traditional Arts in Thimphu, Bhutan. Now, if happiness really, you know, came from having more money or eating outside or owning luxury collection of cars, then what we see on the right-hand side of this slide, according to the World Happiness Report, basically, you know, worry, anxiety, stress, tension, all of these have escalated over the years, which is definitely not a good sign. Now, as you can see in the slide over here, what this is trying to convey is our overall well-being is largely, or rather completely, being determined by the size of our wallets. The broad parameters of overall well-being, you know, tend to be good health, a relaxed mind, and a stable source of income. Now, a clear distinction must be drawn here that when we say a stable source of income, we are just ensuring that we have sufficient income or money that can sustain us. But, you know, the situation nowadays is mostly that people are running after money. They are running after the size of their wallet. So heavy wallet is not to be confused with a stable source of income. Now, although we are all running towards overall well-being, however, there are several factors that comes in the way and pulls us back from sustaining this happiness. For example, we tend to move towards good health, but we have very bad food habits. We are taking stress. We are leading sedentary lifestyles, late night snacking, all of these things. In order to have a relaxed mind, we run for jobs, a better salary, a lot of these things, but we are probably working around the clock. which is leading to stress and arguments. Even for a stable source of income, people are mostly running for more money, and they are, in that case, trying to provide 24/7 service. They are always running. They are trying to climb up the corporate ladders, and they are trying to do multitasking. So the question that one really needs to ask at this point is whether we are really running towards, you know, sustainable health and happiness, or are we turning our own intelligence against ourselves? Now, the top three countries are basically the world's happiest countries, according to the happiness report, World Happiness Report, which places Finland with an index of freedom of 72.56, followed by Denmark with 75.26, and followed by Switzerland with an index of freedom as 81.03 as the world's happiest countries. Now, besides the, you know, like pleasant geographical location and pleasant climate, they have different demographic features that makes them the happiest countries. They have different work-life cultures and all of those things. While this paints a really impressive picture, but at the same time, if we see the national health expenditure as a share of GDP in US, so this is not the most recent data, but if you follow the trend, what we are seeing over here, that the healthcare spending has definitely escalated over the years, which is, again, not a good sign that the world is moving towards. An average American adult, you know, spends typically more than 11 hours per day watching, listening to music, or, you know, interacting with the different kinds of media. This has been published by one of the recent studies by Nielsen. And the global lifestyle trends reveals that we are continually trying to stretch our abilities to achieve overall well-being, but most of us are running probably in the wrong direction. It is critical to proactively understand the short and long-term implications of such lifestyles. Now, the role of artificial intelligence, definitely technological, you know, innovation has made mind-boggling improvements over the last few decades. And with artificial intelligence and IoT, that is Internet of Things, coming into the picture, the lives of every human being is expected to be touched in some way or the other. And that would be radically different from how technology has, you know, touched our lives till this date. Now, however, as like in any technological innovation, there are pros and cons, right? So the pros would be, you know, automation. In terms of artificial intelligence coming into the picture, there would be a lot of automation, which would lead to less of human time involvement and more of machine time being involved. This would also lead to economies of scale, better production capabilities, efficiency, a lot of these things, better economic benefits and standard of living. While these are the good things, and there are a lot of other factors also, this would also definitely lead to significant loss of jobs in different sectors. It would lead to power in the hands of only a few who would, you know, have access to this knowledge or technology. And this would also lead to lesser human-to-human interconnection. I think the grave mistakes that have been made by societies in general are in not realizing how to use technology in their favor, but rather become a slave of it. Now, machines cannot really replace humans. I think this is a worry that, you know, many of us are suffering from right now with the advent of artificial intelligence, like what will happen to our jobs, with this kind of automation. But it's important to realize machines can't replace humans totally. If machines are being created by humans, certainly we would have an upper hand in working in a more integrated way with machines. So this fear in people's minds about the job security brings us into this, you know, crux of the topic, that what is the way forward? So the way forward, as we can see in the left-hand side picture, it's not, you know, fighting or battling against artificial intelligence or technology, but the approach is, you know, rather to embrace that technology. So the left-hand side picture shows that you're, you know, shaking your hands with an automated robot or thing like that.
Sorry to interrupt you. Can you just brief the rest of your presentation in next 1 minute or two?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. Now, in this era of artificial intelligence, we have seen a lot of different innovations which are really interesting, like Amazon Alexa. So Alexa, you can tell anything to Alexa, play a song or book an appointment with a doctor, Alexa can book it. You know, long call hours at customer service centers are nowadays being managed by virtual assistants and chatbots. I think IBM Watson has made this entire sector, revolutionized this entire sector of chatbots. Sensors are being fit to different home appliances to give a more personalized consumer experience. Now, while all of that is going to revolutionize the way humans would interact, it is worthwhile to weigh the consequences of such technological breakthroughs on the sustainability of health and happiness. I think due to a significant reduction in human physical labor through automation happening at scale, reprioritizing some of the areas, such as having a more health-centered approach, may definitely prove to be a sure shot way to reduce the inflammations that has been caused by the lure towards wealth and money creation. So, and I think the purpose of technology has always been to ease our lives. But the main question all of us need to ask is if you're making our lives simpler or more complicated. I think the way forward would be adopting and embracing technologies and techniques to relax, practice meditation and yoga, listen more often to music, travel to be happy, and these are the other things basically one can do. So that's all for the presentation that I had. Thanks for your valuable time. I'm doing further research on this topic. So if you want to reach out to me, you can reach out to me in the email address I have shared below. Thank you.
So thank you so much for this wonderful talk. And I think the participant can mail you about the questions. Will it be okay for you?
Absolutely, sure.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you. Participants will let you know about how to contact him. And now we are going to the next speaker. Saima Samreen, a researcher from Aligarh Muslim University, Uttar Pradesh. Are you with us? Can you hear me? Saima Samreen? Yeah. Saima, please unmute yourself. I sent you a request to unmute yourself. Yeah. Do you have any presentation with you?
Yes, ma'am. I want to share the screen.
Yeah. Just see the green button in the share screen. It says.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it's visible. Saima is visible.
Okay.
You just proceed with your contribution and you have 5 to 6 minutes.
Okay.
Yes.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Saima Samreen and my topic of presentation is phytoremediation potency of some native plants for restoration of function and services of ecosystem, a sustainable approach.
Thank you.
Taima, we suggest you that you need not to go to the presentation mode. Okay, just maximize your screen and just tell.
Yeah, right.
Just maximize your screen. Yeah, that's beautiful. Just go ahead with your presentation.
Starting with introduction, the richness of species, functional group or genotype comprises biodiversity that govern the magnitude and efficiency of ecosystem processes and property. The figure is showing the plant biodiversity profile of India. Here you can see gymnosperm comprises 0%, angiosperm 32%, fungi 49%, dodophyte 2%, algae 13%, and bryophyte 44%. Ecosystem owe their functioning to the biodiversity as the biological community. A biotic component are the sum total of all living organisms in an ecosystem. Biodiversity is essential for providing ecosystem goods and services to human society. Biodiversity crisis now a global accepted reality. Ecologists' deep concern for biodiversity loss is because of following reason. Habitat destruction may cause certain species to go extinct with narrow distribution range or endemic constitute high risk group. The figure is showing the flowering plants facing threat of extinction in India. Nearly 8% of species are facing threat of extinction. The species depleted ecosystem are likely to have reduced functionality. Properly functioning ecosystem provides services and products that are lifeline for human existence. Now the heavy metals. Heavy metals are most commonly most toxic elements to plants and animal ecosystem, having a specific gravity greater than 4 to 5 or more. But post-industrial evolution era has witnessed as unprecedented and rapid modification of environment, which overrides its natural balancing ability, leading to different environment problems like climate change, ozone layer depletion, as well as inorganic pollution due to human matters. Heavy metals. Heavy metals have been divided into essential, beneficial, and toxic elements based on their physiological role in biological system. Beyond a threshold level of a concentration within plant, essential and beneficial elements also show detrimental effects. Now the importance of phytoremediation. Phytoremediation is new in situ remediation biotechnology that uses plants to remove the heavy metal from soil. It is gaining widespread public acceptance and have low cost compared with traditional technology. Many plants has been studied for their ability to remediate heavy metals and metallites like nickel, silver, lead, copper, cadmium, zinc, copper, arsenic, with important progress being made. While plants are resilient and perform the functions of phytoremediation, scavenging and accumulating excess of heavy metals and restoring ecosystem functions and service. Now, my objective is to study the phytoremediation efficiency of 7 common growing native plants against chromium and nickel contamination in illegal localities. These plants are Pidens, Pilosa, Chenopodium album, Malvestrum corymandelianum, Oxalis cornicorata, Parthenium hystericorus, Polypogon monospheliensis, and Rumex dentatus. The 3 indices were calculated to evaluate the capacity of all the 7 species for metal accumulation. These indices are biological concentration factor, biological accumulation coefficient, and translocation factor. Here you can see the table which is showing translocation factor, biological concentration factor, and biological accumulation coefficient of Pidens, Chenopodium, and Malvestrum oxalis as 90 days after the sowing. Pidens has highest TF value for nickel, however, chromium translocate, Chenopodium translocate chromium more efficiently. Chenopodium show highest BCF and BAC value for chromium. This table is showing the translocation factor, biological concentration factor, and biological accumulation coefficient of Parthenium, Polypogon, and Rumex at 90 days after sowing. Rumex, Dentatus, and Parthenium show highest BCF and BAC values for nickel, whereas Parthenium show highest BCF and BAC values for chromium. My conclusion is Parthenium displayed enhanced tolerance towards a low concentration of chromium nickel besides accumulating high chromium nickel in root and shoot, thus serving as suitable contender for phytoremediation. Secondly, Bidens and Athenium are more tolerant for both metals and express phytostabilization, plasticity, shifting biomass accumulation to root to shoot from chromium for chromium and nickel. Thirdly, Malvestrum and Parthenium with high BAC values compared to other plant species can be used for phytoaccumulator for both these of both these metals. Finally, Chenopodium efficiently transmuted nickel and chromium metal from root to shoot indicate that these plant can use for phytoextraction for these metals. Thank you.
Thank you for your nice paper, Shamya. Who will we have as next speaker?
Yeah, the next speaker is Supriti Mukherjee. Supriti, are you here? Are you here with us? Saima, can you just stop your share screen? We request participants to contact through mail. Contact through mail. If you have any question about Saima's presentation, please contact through mail. We will deliver you the required information. You can ask her through mail. Yeah, I think Supriti Mukherjee, she is already there. She unmuted herself. Do you have any presentation, Supriti?
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you're clearly audible. Do you have any presentation? You can
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah, we can see.
Okay, ma'am. Is it visible, ma'am?
Yes, it is. Hello? Visible. Hello, it's visible.
Okay.
Start.
Okay, ma'am. Good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank the principal and the organizing committee members of BB College to conduct such a wonderful conference and give me the opportunity to be a part of this glorious moment. Today, I'm going to discuss about shift of Millennium Development Goals towards Sustainable Development Goals for Sustainable Culture. In ancient time, our Vedic thinkers or Muni Rishis always emphasized on Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. That is, the world is one family. Means every living aspects are the part of, so that we become sympathetic to all living aspects in our actions. As the time passes by, as the development of science and technology occurred, the world has realized the same thing in its efforts towards sustainable development in last 3 to 4 decades. Now, to establish a fairer and more sustainable world for all, the world leaders set an agenda in 2015, popularly known as Transforming Our World, which assures sustainable development throughout the world by 2030 as a shared dream. It has 17 goals known as SDGs with 169 targets. Here are the 17 sustainable development goals. I'm not reading all the 17 sustainable development goals one after one because of the shortage of time. Viewers are requested to go through the slide. But one thing which I should mention here is that sustainable development goals basically cover the social, economic, and environmental.
Interruption. Shupit, it doesn't state the obvious. Please come to your conclusion.
Okay, sir. Sectors of the society, which in turn known as three pillars of sustainable development, when these three pillars are intersecting each other, we found sustainability in common zone of their intersection. But the practical and the political importance of the SDGs and the SDGs and the challenges associated with them can only be appreciated by understanding what preceded them. So before sustainable development goals, there are Millennium Development Goals in place. Here are those 8 Millennium Development Goals. These are eradicating extreme poverty and hunger, achieve universal primary education, promote gender equality and empower women, reduce child mortality, improve maternal health, combating HIV, AIDS, malaria, and other diseases, ensure environmental sustainability, and develop a global partnership. These Millennium Development Goals basically covered social, health, and environmental sectors of the society, but it gave more emphasis on health sector and less emphasis on environmental sector. Now we move towards the most important part of this paper, that is the shift of Millennium Development Goals towards Sustainable Development Goals. So definitely there are some reasons behind the shift of MDGs to SDGs. MDGs excluded some important issues such as peace, security, and human rights. MDGs agenda didn't address issues of concern for middle-income countries. MDGs had many poorly defined targets for strengthening the global partnership for development. It has lack of clarity, lack of alignment between some goals and targets, and it also created tensions between national and international statistics due to discrepancies between national and international monitoring systems and data. Now we move towards its implementation part. Here we basically discuss how the implementation of SDGs become possible throughout worldwide. SDGs is a collective process which requires collective support from all the relevant actors. These relevant actors of the society are central government and local government, civil society organization, knowledge institution, private sector organization, and obviously the youth generation of our society. Next part is its awareness. Awareness is very much important for the successful implementation of SDGs. To foster awareness in different countries, social media like Facebook, different websites, Twitter have played an important role. These are used to share information with public regarding different issues of SDGs. Now we shift towards its next important part, that is SDGs provide sustainable culture or not. Obviously, sustainable development goals are able to provide a sustainable culture worldwide, because SDGs agenda is a plan of action for people, planet, and prosperity. Firstly, SDGs ensure that all human beings can fulfill their potential in dignity and equality in a healthy environment by eradicating poverty and hunger in all their forms and dimensions. Secondly, SDGs help to prevent the planet from all sorts of degradation by including sustainable consumption and production, sustainable management of natural resources, and urgent actions on climate change. Thirdly, SDGs allow a prosperous, fulfilling lives to all human beings and assure the occurrence of economic, social, and technological process in harmony with nature. Fourthly, SDGs foster a peaceful and inclusive societies for the mankind, which are free from fear and violence. There can be no sustainable development without peace, and no peace without sustainable development. And lastly, SDGs allowed global partnership for sustainable development, where there is no violence and conflict, which in turn help to prevent the world from war and disagreement. In conclusion, I must say that the success of SDGs with all its dimensions depend upon we people, our awareness, and the collective contribution of the process. Thank you, sir, for your valuable time.
Thank you so much, Shupriti. Thank you for this wonderful talk. And I think I'll have to say once again, the participant, please send a mail if you have any question about Shupriti Mukherjee's wonderful talk with this new topic. And now we are moving to the next speaker, Shorup Akhuli. He's a faculty from Deshbandhu Mahavidyalaya, Chittoranjan, West Bengal, India. So, Mr. Shorup, are you with us? Shupriti, we are requesting you to stop sharing your screen so that the next speaker can share. Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah. Request technical team to connect with Mr. Shorup Akhuli. Mr. Shorup Akhuli, you can just unmute yourself. We can't hear you. Yeah, you are audible now. Do you have PowerPoint presentation?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so please share your screen with the green button.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, Ma'am, my screen is visible?
Yeah, your screen is visible. Just go to your
presentation.
You have to go to presentation mode. It is
okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, that's all.
I am Swarup Akuli, the guest lecturer of geography, Deshbandhu Mahavidyalaya, Chittaranjan, Paschim Bardhaman. Today I discuss my topic mixed farming and sustainable development. Agriculture is the most important occupation of human society.
Mouthpiece a little bit nearer to your mouth, the mouthpiece of your headphone, nearer to your mouth.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, it's better now. You just continue, please. You have 5 to 6 minutes.
Agriculture is the most important occupation of human society. Various agriculture peta are introduced from time to time, such as intensive subsistence agriculture, commercial grain farming, plantation agriculture, mixed farming, etc. Mixed farming is one of the most important way of sustainable development. What is mixed farming? Mixed farming is a type of farming which involves both the growing of crops and the raising of livestock. The type of farming is practiced across Asia and in countries such as India, Indonesia, Afghanistan, South Africa, China, Central Europe, Canada and Russia. Mixed farming is the growing of food crop or cash crop, feed crop and livestock on the same farm. What do you mean? What is the sustainable development? Sustainable development has been defined in many ways, but the most frequently quoted definition is from our common future, also known as Brundtland Commission. Sustainable development is development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. What is the object of this paper? The object of this paper is to identify the relationship between mixed farming and sustainable development. How mixed farming is to minimize the risks of cultivation. Find out the relationship between cultivation and livestock ranching. Prove the statement that mixed farming is one of the ways of sustainable development. Methodology, the study is based on the farm and traditional wisdom on agriculture as well as mixed farming as initiated through non-random selection of respondents from some different communities of the villager who are directly and indirectly related to the activities. Study area, the village Kendrabona, locally known as Kendrabona, is situated within the extent nearly 23 degree 24 minute north to 23 degree 24 minute 45 second north latitude and 86 degree 3 minute 45 second east to 86 degree 4 minute east longitude. The village is under Gangajal Gram Panchayat of Gangajal Ghati Gram, Bakuda district of West Bengal. Process of mixed farming. Mixed cropping is also known as the polyculture. Intercropping and co-cultivation is a type of agriculture that involves plantation or more plants sustained simultaneously in the same field. Material used for mixed farming. I address the three key of sustainable development. Mixed farming, one is financial, another is soil, and next is the weeds. How are the advantages of mixed farming? In this farming, farmer can keep their fields under continuous production. It enhances productivity of the farm. It increases the per capita profitability, increases the level of nutrition, great food security, provides a farmer with multiple sources of income, and last, it enhances the productivity of the farmer also. Way of sustainable development. Why mixed farming is the way of sustainable development? Mixed farming has a very important role to play in the sustainable of farming. The ability to include a pasture phase or green manure into the system is paramount, is building the soil and profitability of the farm. Conclusion, the mixed farming has been very important role to play in the sustainable of farming. The ability of include a pasture phase or green manure into the system of paramount in building the soil and profitability of the farm. Little then simply means there is a return of money invest in this tool. So it is concluded that in this process we may agriculture, the process is sustainable and profit the farmer and the village is more and more sustainability. Thank you for your valuable time.
Thank you so much, Mr. Swarup. Thank you for this very knowledgeable lecture. And dear participants, you can connect with him through mail if you have any questions.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. And we are very happy. Just 1 second. We are very happy to say that we have one participant from Nigeria, and he is with us in our international conference. Our technical team, can you focus him? He is Mr. O.O. Yeshua from Civil and Environmental Engineering Department, AB University, Ekiti State, Nigeria. Hi, Mr. Yeshua. We are very happy to have you, and you are so patiently, you have attended the whole lecture, you have given your abstract and your presentation, and we are also, it's our pleasure to say that your presentation will be available in our virtual meeting room, virtual oral presentation room. Okay, so we request you to say that what is your experience after so patiently watching the whole conference, which shows patience. Yeah, we want to hear from you. Yeah, can you say a few words?
Thank you very much. I'm really happy to be part of this conference. I'm really happy. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. So I will quickly present my slide, and I will make a few comments before I continue. So my topic is engineering law, strategies, and managerial economics for sustainable infrastructural development in Nigeria. I hope you can see my screen. Is my screen visible?
Yes, your screen is visible.
Yes.
You have 4 minutes, so, please proceed.
Yes, I'm from the Afibola University, Adwekiti, Nigeria. Okay. It's a private university, and I'm happy to be part of this conference. This is my outline. I have the introduction, material and methods, results, conclusion and recommendation. It is very imperative to revisit engineering law, strategies and management for sustainable development in developing countries like Nigeria, India and some other countries. They are working very hard. I'm really impressed by this conference. Infrastructure is the medium, the tools and techniques of a project or program or strategy. Civil engineering infrastructure are essential for hygienic environment, national sustainable development. Revisiting strategies for sustainable development is very crucial at this period. This paper investigated the impact of laws, strategies, and managerial economy for sustainable development in Nigeria. This will enhance integrity of consultancy services, procurement of quality materials for construction, sustainable water supply, and sustainable development. So we can see these figures showing the demands and performance metrics. Most of these are security is very, very germane, safety, energy, environment, durability, and all that. And we know that sustainability is hinged on 3 points, which you have the society, economic, and environment. And what are the challenges? The one identified include the mismanagement of fund, breach of contract, finance and technology for development, maintenance and design. The challenges are also include international requirement of project to be sustainably developed. These challenges are many, but any serious government can overcome them as a result of incessant research and development in the infrastructural development worldwide. So we have this social, economic, environmental, and all these are very, very germane to the our environment, like climate change, resource depletion, marine, air, soil pollution. Those are the major issues, and this needs to be addressed. This is a well-planned road for sustainable infrastructure development. All the road users, they must be comfortable. Everything must be well done for the health and wealth of the populace. Then the research methodology include the resonance survey, site inspection, literature review of infrastructure in Nigeria. The observation includes the infrastructure development, which is the basis of measuring the performance of democratic leaders, and it is of the foundation of good democratic governance. Many people, they look at the development based on what the performance of people in government. Notable strategy were highlighted for sustainable development. And the result, findings reveal that important strategies, very crucial for capacity building. Project must also meet the carbon emission standard set by international organization. Communities must be biodiversified and emit as little greenhouse gases as possible. Natural environment must be preserved. Then I go to conclusions. it has been concluded that there is need to revisit strategies for sustainable development in Nigeria for better policy, economy, and infrastructural development. Revisiting strategies for sustainable development is the way forward for sustainable national growth, optimal delivery of manpower, and protection of the environment in most nations of the world. And I have a few recommendations, which include urgent attention by government and all stakeholders is very important. Good governance, like I said before, that we promote accountability with drastic reduction in corruption and minimal resource wastage must be imbibed by government for efficiency and better strategy. Good policy needs to be put in place as part of strategy for infrastructural development. Remarks. I congratulate the organizer of this conference. This is a great conference. I'm really, really happy about the conference. I congratulate the host, keynote speakers, invited guests, presenters for this timely contribution. Beautiful and wonderful presentation. I really enjoy all the sessions. All they are very carefully selected, all the speakers. International conference, e-conference on revisiting strategies for sustainable development is a successful, comprehensive, and impactful virtual conference. I really congratulations. Thank you very much. I'm really happy for the opportunity given me for this presentation. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now we are also very happy to have you with us. And also, we want to share the screen for one message. We just got a few minutes ago. Yeah, from Mark Anthony Gayona from Philippines. And he's saying that a good evening here from Philippines time, 7:40 p.m. right now. Thank you so much, Yeshua. Now we are just transferring the focus to the share screen. Technical team, can you do it? We just got a message just a few minutes ago that he has told that Mark Anthony Gayona, he is from Philippines. He has been attentively seen the conference and he has given us the feedback for this session. Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah, you can close it. Okay. So, thank you, participants. Thank you, all participants, for gifting us and enriching us with such a wonderful session. Due to large response actually that we received, we could not accommodate all of you in the online session, and we really apologize for that. It has been really challenging for us to accommodate so many participants. So we request you all to join the eConsa's Telegram channel to enter the virtual oral presentation room of our conference. We will just upload the presentations there. You can see, you can interact with participants through mail or some other platform we'll provide. And every participation in our virtual oral presentation room in Telegram channel will be treated as a oral presenter, full-fledged oral presentation. And a certificate of participation and presentation will be sent to them after getting the feedback form through email or through the Google form within 15 days. And we have finally come to the concluding session of this two-day-long international conference, eConsas, and eminent speakers from India and abroad and various researchers and respected faculties from all over the India have participated and delighted us with their insights and bright ideas to revisit various sustainable development goals, which may lead us to the way out of this dark time. I now request our Honorable Principal, Dr. Amitabh Basu, Banwarilal Bhalotia College, and the Chairman of eConsas 2020, for delivering the concluding remarks. We'll take 5 seconds for that technical arrangement. Yeah, please be with us. Thank you.
Very good afternoon, everybody. I express my heartfelt gratitude to all concerned associated with our international conference. It is really an enriching experience for all of us, and I hope all the participants are very much enlightened by the valuable and informative lectures by our resource person. We have just completed our fourth session with four keynote speakers, eight invited speakers, and we have submitted more than 113 abstract from the faculties and researchers. And you all know, due to time constraint, we have permitted only 27 papers for this presentation. Though we have available all our papers in our through Telegram channels. And thank you very much for warmly response from all part of the world. It is truly an international seminar. And as I mentioned in my welcome address, that we are really doubtful about the conference, how it will be arranged. So the skepticism at the inception of our conference now has transformed into our confidence. And in future too, we can organize such international conference on such a scale using digital platform. And I want to say that this COVID-19 period, you all know that there are some paradoxical things is going on, and you know the some things is that due to COVID-19 period, there is a economic setback, but in the education on and at the same time there is a restoration of the nature, and on the education sector also we are witnessing this type of technological facility, and it also raising voice that there is a question of have and have nots. There are some peoples they have the facilities of accessing all this internet connectivity, smartphone, laptop, everything. They are accessing all these things. And there are some people that they have not. They are not access all such facilities, connectivity facilities. So this is all about our conference, how to balance, how to strike a balance between these extremes. This is about conference. And at the end, I once again thank all who have endeavored to make this international conference successful. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I now request our joint convener, Mr. Rajorshi Dash, to deliver the vote of thanks of this conference.
Thank you, Vinita. Amake shona jacche to?
Yeah, you are clearly audible.
Yeah. Wait, now it's all right?
Yes,
it's fine. Okay. Good evening, everyone. It has been very fascinating and very engaging 2 days. So indulge me for 5 minutes, because it's just not us, the key persons you are listening and seeing, but also a huge team with us who we haven't heard of. But first of all, my heartfelt thanks goes out to Dr. Amitabh Basu, Principal, Vivek College, for leading us all through this. I also extend my thanks to, is it all right?
Yes, it's all right. Fine.
I also extend my thanks to Dr. Kajol Krishna De, coordinator IQAC, for extending his full support to our endeavor. I thank my joint convener, Dr. Sudipto Dash, for his painstaking attention to the details. I thank Dr. Vinita Dutta, organizing secretary, for taking pains in micromanaging things for the event and for her creativity. I thank Dr. Shutaba Bosu and C. Arup Ghosh, our technical advisor, for being human networking partner to us in way of connecting to us keynote speakers. You have been exceptionally helpful behind the scene and doing all that for us. I think audience have been the exceptionally helpful too. I think I must say that I have been very impressed and touched by the ability of the participants in digital. And I think they deserve the huge round of applause for actually being able to engage with us by asking stimulating questions also. You have been very disciplined, imbibing virtual meeting room etiquettes and culture. You answered the feedback form that had been set out for you. I thank you so much. I thank to all the keynotes and invited speakers for sparing their precious time for us. I thank Swami Deva Priyodandoji for reminding us the human factor. and putting people first in the discourse of development. I thank Dr. Vignesh Chandramohan for narrating to us the important role that library can play in attaining sustainable development goals and what is the National Digital Library of India is doing about it. I thank Dr. Aparajita Sengupta for her fascinating story of a budding organic farm, a model for sustainable agriculture, and how the farmers are trained and initiated in the way of organic farming. I thank you, Dr. Ulrich Berg, for enchanting us with the methods of Agnihotra and the role it played in fighting even the novel virus COVID-19. I thank Sri Suman Kumar Guha for his deliberation on waste management methods, the greatest challenge nowadays. I thank Dr. Shundip Kaur for her wonderful talk, the case study of Malwa region of Punjab that involves bottom-up and organic approach to the issues in agriculture, public health, and economy. I thank Dr. Partho Sharathi Ray for explaining the inner mechanism of SARS-CoV-2, which caused the havoc of COVID-19 pandemic universally. He stressed also that this pandemic is a natural outcome of the dominant development discourse that we have. This development model is responsible not only for the climate hazards, it's also responsible for the conflict between human and animals. I thank Dr. Pralay Tarandash for explaining diverse use of nanomagnetism and for giving us a peek to the better future with 3D nanotechnology, which is capable of shaping and reshaping our world for the betterment. I thank Dr. Prosenjit Shah for showing us a wonderful way to reclaim waste rubber in an eco-friendly manner. I thank Dr. Monotosh Dashgupta for deliberating on harmonious assimilation of godly love, humanness, and the objectives of sustainable development in the light of traditional wisdom. He also imparted how to manage sustainably the anxieties of the future generations for their betterment. I thank Dr. Vishwajit Rooj for his deliberation on resource-efficient solutions in the context of ecological degradation. I thank Dr. Niranjana Dev for her profound insight on the ecological crisis that plagued the cities, particularly Kolkata, and the arrogance of the city she talked about in the death of birds and bees. I thank her for that. I personally thank Parthoda, Aparajita Di, Nilanjana Di, Prosenjit Babu, Vishwajit Babu, Madam Sandeep Kaur, and Dr. Vignesh Chandramohan for sharing their knowledge with us in such a short notice. My special thanks goes to the technical team for being in the college in this time and sitting and managing technicalities all through these 2 days. It's unbelievable that kind of dedication they have put across. I'll take out individual names. Dr. Porimal Ghosh, I thank you. Dr. Animesh Mondal, Mr. Manush Roy, Mr. Arghya Deshorkar, Sri Biru Rojo, Assistant Professor, Asansol Girls College, a real friend in need. I thank you all. I acknowledge the role of the support staff, Sri Rajiv Gupta, Sri Shoumo Banerjee, Sri Anup Jadhav, Sri Julfikar Ali, Sri Shohel Ahmed, Sri Tribeni Ruidas, Sri Bir Bahadur, and I acknowledge for food and refreshment the role that played by the Shikanto Lai and the Kanai Ruidas. I thank you all. Now I come to the very important part where I must mention the collective that has been responsible for putting together this mammoth exercise of organizing an e-conference of international standard. They are all early career professionals. I am mentioning here and the website monitoring committee. Apart from the name I have mentioned, I will take out the list of the names. Shri Kajol Majhi, Dr. Rajrupa Ghosh, Dr. Sangeeta Lahiri, Shoshi Kumar Shah, Dr. Shubharti Sarkar, Ms. Charka Jamal. I thank you all. My special word of thanks for Shri Kajol Majhi for being such a wonderfully silent, but also a hardworking person. I thank you, Kajal. I must mention here the website monitoring committee is an embodiment of the excellence and commitment that BB College stands for. BB College stands for the knowledge creation and dissemination. Join me in giving a big round of applause to all our colleagues. I extend my heartfelt thanks to all of you. Without you, sir and madam, participating in large number with your wonderful contributions and papers and animate our sessions with stimulating questions, pointing out things for betterment, we may not soar to this height of success that we have achieved through your participation. It is for you that we could have been most inclusive in our approach by giving access to the live platforms to the guest presenters, not you, sir and madam, from across India and abroad. We have arranged the different platform and different online similar channel for you to present your paper that you know and talked about. a little reminiscing will not be out of place here. I fondly remember the days when I had moved into Asansol. And I fondly remember while staying there, I found myself in the milieu of certain inquiring, critically assessing and beautiful minds. The colleagues, I mean, at that time, they were the colleagues and became friends afterwards. We exchanged thought, ideas and plans. And in one such occasion, I expressed my wish personally to a friend, the colleague friend, to organize an internet conference from our college. So it is kind of a wish and commitment fulfillment in my part as well. So I acknowledge and thank that friend as well. Earlier, I had generated an idea of arranging talks periodically, selecting and using resources that we have within our faculty staff. I remember that Sudipto inaugurated one such program with his talk. Therefore, in this concluding day of in-conference, I recall with fondness this journey, which has been more personal than professional. Well, now a little announcement is in order. We are looking forward to edit and publish a book, the conference proceedings, with your full papers. We would like to request the speakers and presenters to submit their full papers in our conference mail ID by latest by 15 July 2020. We would inform the full details also in mail and through our Telegram channel. So stay updated with us through our channels. We have a plan to come forward with the many more such exercises afterwards. Now we are going to play the Jana Gana Mana, the full song, the first stanza of which is a national anthem. So you may rise to your feet to that. Over to you, Vinita.
Thank you so much, Rajarshi. And thanks to all the organizing committee members, all the technical team and all the participants and the eminent speakers we have, we are really privileged. And it's our kind of dream come true that we could just organize such international conference for the first time in our college. Yeah, we are, and you already know that we are already publishing a conference proceeding with your full papers. And we also say that all the participants with accepted abstracts can contribute the full paper. Means it includes the participants who could not send us the video also, but they have got that acceptance mail of their abstract. They can send us full paper, and you have 1 month of time. Please finish your writing. Just 2 seconds I'm taking. Sorry for some technical issues. Means that if you have just sent us abstracts and we sent you that you have accepted your abstract, you can send us full paper. Just you have 1 month, you just finish your full paper, and we'll give you the detailed guidelines through mail and send to us before 15th of July 2020. And fill up today's feedback form. And we also request you to attend our virtual oral presentation room in Telegram channel. You'll get many other lectures which we could not accommodate in the online sessions. Yeah, you can find many other enriching presentations, I must say. And we also request you to kindly mail us and let us know about the lectures you have attended in this conference, whatever you have watched the presentations in the Telegram channel. Tell us about that how you feel, your valuable opinion about the overall event of eConcerts and its organization, and also share your suggestions with us so that in future we can do more such conferences with much more confidence. So we'll end our conference with our national anthem of India, and we request all the participants to kindly stand up for the national anthem of India, and after the national anthem we'll just close our conference session. So meet you soon, send us the feedback through your mails. We'll just eagerly waiting for that, your positively. And please stand up for the national anthem. We'll just start.